We believe in democracy, not oligarchy. Today, we say to the private health insurance companies, whether you like it or not, the United States will join every other major country on earth and guarantee health care to all people as a right. Healthcare is a human right, not a privilege. And together, we will pass a Medicare for All single-payer program.
You're listening to the David Feldman radio program, you sad, pathetic hump.
Joining us is the founder and treasurer of the Blue America PAC, which raises money for progressive and some socialist candidates around America. And read them over Down with Tyranny. We have a lot to talk about. I want to talk to you about Stephanie Kelton, who is going to end up being President Sanders' Secretary of the Treasury or head of the Fed.
That's my hope, is that she's going to be the Secretary of the Treasury. She would be, I think, still the greatest.
Yeah. And impeachment. Nadler, Ed Randell, Sean King, African-American support among Bernie. You know, I don't thank you enough, so I'm going to thank you, because besides booking this show and giving me and my audience the best education in politics, you got me into Bernie. And one of the things, and I apologize for this, is I voted for Bernie, but I took him for granted because I am Bernie. I'm not as talented as Bernie and smart, but I ooze Bernie Sanders. I was born in Brooklyn. The more I learn about him, the pictures of his arrests alone, being chained to those African-American women in Chicago, marching with Martin Luther King, which he kept quiet because he felt it was unseemly.
Right. Could you imagine a guy with dignity instead of like something like Trump, I mean, who doesn't even know what the word dignity means?
Yeah. Yeah. You knew about Bernie 5 years ago. I always looked at him on C-SPAN and said, this is.
Oh, I knew about Bernie long, long ago. I was following him when he was in the House. Mm-hmm. I worshipped him. I mean, this is a guy who got into the House of Representatives running as an independent, and he always had two opponents. He always had a Republican conservative opponent and a Democratic conservative opponent. You know, until Howard Dean came along and said, stop, 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 the Democrats ran candidates against him. People don't realize that. He did not, he ran as an independent, he served as an independent, and he founded the Congressional Progressive Caucus. He was the president of it as well, or the chairman of it. And the Democrats ran people against him, always corporate whores to the right of him. Always, mm-hmm. always. That's how they decided to play it. And, of course, they always lost.
He speaks to why we need an electoral college, because he's a product of Vermont, not Brooklyn. He never would have gotten this far through the Brooklyn machine. It's Vermont. We need those states. We need them to speak up, because without those states that are not populated, we wouldn't have McGovern, we wouldn't have had Eugene McCarthy, we wouldn't have Proxmire, Mondale, or Bernie. We need, or Eugene Debs. We need the states.
Wisconsin is populated.
Not like New York, Texas.
Oh, but I mean, they have Milwaukee. That's a pretty big city.
Yeah, sure. If you're from Des Moines, it's a big city. So I watched the rallies on YouTube. I watched Bernie in Brooklyn and I watched Bernie in Chicago, and I guess you have a story for us about Chicago. But let's talk about New York first. That has to have the Democrats terrified. I've never seen crowds like that. How can you not?
Neither have they.
How can you not be?
I mean, Democrat gets crowds like that. I mean, I remember when I was a kid and JFK came to Brooklyn. I've told the story, so I won't go into the whole story. But that's the kind of crowds JFK got. People were really, really enthusiastic. You know, do you think anyone is enthusiastic about Amy Klobuchar? Exactly.
Who's getting anything close to that? Trump.
Yes. Of course, people are enthusiastic about Trump. He means something to their lives, as Bernie does to our lives. But these other clowns, you know, they're Rachel Maddow makes them into a celebrity. So, but they're opening acts is basically what they are.
Is Elizabeth Warren, is Kamala, is she getting anything like this?
Those two are. They're not like Bernie, but they're both getting reasonably large audiences. You know, I'm talking about Bernie from the 2016 campaign, and then Bernie has only done two public events so far, the one in the Navy Pier, mm-hmm. and then the one at Brooklyn College. The Navy Pier one was interesting because when Bernie put that together, I mean, I'm speaking out of school here, so please, everybody who's listening, do not tell anyone, right? I'm just telling you, keep it to yourselves. So when he put that together, Jesus Chuy Garcia was going to be one of the speakers. Absolutely going to be one of the speakers.
And who is Chuy Garcia?
I was going to ask that if you didn't, but thank you. So he was a what do they call it there? Like a county commissioner, like their version of a city councilman, whatever that is. I can't remember. He was one of them. He was so kind of a local big shot, very progressive. He decided to take on Rahm Emanuel in a run for mayor. And, you know, this wouldn't have gotten a lot of attention except for one thing. Bernie came to Chicago several times campaigning for him. Hmm. So here is Chuy Garcia, a local Latino activist, and here's Bernie coming in and pumping him up and making him into someone who is known not just locally. I mean, Chuy didn't need Bernie to make him a local star. He already was. But Chuy came in and made him into a national star. No one had ever heard of him before. And he didn't win, but he did very well. And then when a seat came open in his district, which is, by the way, a district that Bernie won. Now, the Chicago machine pretty much swept Chicago for Hillary. Mm-hmm. So Hillary won every single black neighborhood in Chicago by a landslide. She won everywhere.
In the primaries.
Bernie won in the primary. Bernie won downstate. Mm-hmm. So, you know, he dominated outside of the most controlled wards in Chicago. He dominated, generally speaking. And then in this Hispanic district of Chicago, Bernie won as well. And then that district became, the congressman from that district retired, Luis Gutierrez retired, and then several people said they're going to run. One of those people was Chuy. And because of Bernie's strong relationship with Chuy and his immediate endorsement on the first day of Chuy, Chuy swept all of his Democratic opponents away, even though there were some very, very good ones. So it wasn't like just one good guy and a bunch of bad guys. It wasn't that at all. There were quite a few good people running. But, you know, Bernie's help gave Chuy that big, giant push that he needed to become the front runner, and he never looked back. And he's now a member of Congress. He's a freshman member of Congress. So, you know, Bernie had every expectation, as anyone else would, everyone did, that Chuy would be up on that stage on the Navy Pier this weekend. And he wasn't. And the Chicago Sun-Times, I believe, is the paper I read it in, was shocked and asked, you know, what happened? Well, you know, and no one knows except your listeners are going to know right now what happened because no one is telling the story. I can't write about it, really, because, you know, I promise I wouldn't write about it. But no one asked me if I'm going to talk about it or not. What happened was, part of this I don't believe completely the way I got it from a very, very good source that I completely believe, that they are telling me what they heard. So it's a good source, but I don't still, it doesn't sound like Pelosi. But what the source told me basically was that Pelosi is telling members of Congress that they will suffer if they back Bernie publicly. If they come out publicly for Bernie, they will suffer. Now, I've spoken to some members of Congress who already have backed Bernie, and they say they're not suffering, and Pelosi didn't come after them, but did come after some others. What I've sort of put together by questioning here and there and asking is that something very particular happened. It's a little bit of a long story, but do you remember Tony Cardenas?
Refresh my memory.
He's a kind of a sleazy, very like a shady character. He was on the L.A. City Council, and then he ran for Congress in the San Fernando Valley, and he's now a member of Congress. He's a big shot in the congressional progressive, not progressive in any way. He's a big shot in the Congressional Hispanic Caucus. He runs this thing called Bold Pack, which is the way, which, in other words, it's really disgusting, but he goes to, like, the tobacco companies and to the liquor companies and to every kind of horrible group that you could think of, private prisons, payday lenders, all the kind of organizations that no one would want to take money from. I mean, who wants to take money from those kind of people? Nobody. Mm-hmm. But Cardenas goes to them, or has people do it, and they donate to the Hispanic Congressional Caucus's Bold Pack, and then he's got that money, and he hands that money out. So people, you know, can get money from the tobacco companies without ever having to admit or anyone particularly knowing that they're getting tobacco money.
It's money laundering.
It is a kind of money laundering, political money laundering. So that's what Cardenas is known for. So he has a lot of power because of that as well. I don't want to say he raped a girl, but he molested a 16-year-old girl a few years ago. And the girl was the daughter of one of his employees. So he said, if you ever tell anybody that I did this, I'm going to fire your father. So she kept it quiet for a really long time, but she was traumatized by it. And she finally came out publicly, and it was all over the papers and everything. And, you know, it was obvious that he should, you know, that some steps should be taken. But Pelosi basically buried it. She said, well, we're not going to do anything about this. We're going to have an investigation by the Ethics Committee. This is a terrible thing that he did, if he did it. Nothing ever happened. And for some reason, the Republican leader, Kevin McCarthy, went along with it. So basically, McCarthy and Pelosi buried the fact that this complete creep, Tony Cardenas, molested a 16-year-old girl. In the middle of the Me Too movement, this is what happened. This is Pelosi. This is what Nancy Pelosi is. Now, that part is, you know, I absolutely say, yes, that has her fingerprints all over it. That is her. That has always been her. That is Nancy Pelosi, period. The part that I said that isn't Nancy Pelosi is her going up to a member of Congress and threatening them with a committee situation of you're going to lose this committee, you're not going to get this on this committee that you want. That doesn't sound like her. The part that does sound like her is covering up for one of her members in that way, which she did. And also, I mean, something else is completely off the topic here, but I do want to throw it out there. Today she's, you know, going after, she's being part of this group of this lynch mob going after Ilhan Omar to please OPEC, AIPAC, sorry.
Same thing.
And, you know, what happened to listen to black women? Mm-hmm. What is it? We have to amend that now to listen to black women if they agree with us? No more listen to black women? So anyway, but back to the Cardenas Pelosi.
Omar
so,
was at Bus Boys, the bookstore in Washington, and did a reprise of the Follow the Benjamins attack on AIPAC.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, if you want to look for some anti-Semitism and really dig around for it and try your best to find it, maybe you could find it.
Is she Palestinian? Is she Palestinian?
She's from she's a Somali. She's from
Tlaib is Palestinian.
Tlaib is born in the United States, but yes, are you Polish? I mean, you're an American.
What I'm saying is, if she comes from a Palestinian background, you need a Palestinian. I think she was there with Omar when she made those comments. You elect a Palestinian to the Congress to question AIPAC and Israel. That's their responsibility.
I agree, and I think her, I don't think she's going to have a problem with her own constituents, but just but we're mixing up.
Go ahead,
you know, Rashida.
Yeah.
With you know, Rashida is the one who's born in America, but whose family came from Palestine. Whereas Ilhan, she's a naturalized American who was born in I believe Mogadishu.
Okay.
And she was a refugee. The point that I was trying to get to and just went all over the map, and I apologize
for
that.
No, it's great. It's great. Well,
Cardenas is now owned by Pelosi. I mean, literally, she owns him because she covered up the fact that he molested a 16-year-old girl and then threatened her, the girl's father's employment. So, I mean, he shouldn't be in Congress now. He should be in jail now. And maybe he'll be in jail anyway eventually, but I doubt it.
Right.
So he does whatever she wants. He's the one that's going and telling some of the legislators, some members of Congress, if you back Bernie, Pelosi will destroy you. So I don't really think Pelosi is actually doing that. I think Cardenas is doing it for her, or thinking that she that's the way how she wants him to talk. I don't know that she does, because it's not the way she talks. But but in any case, point of the story, Chuy Garcia was not up on the stage, did not endorse Bernie, says he's thinking about it, and it would have been the biggest audience he ever spoke in front of in his entire life. He had an opportunity to get up in front of a gigantic Chicago audience and be a hero, and instead he slinked away like a, you know, like a cur with his tail between his legs.
Shameful. All right. So Chuy didn't step up for Bernie, but if you're playing but if you're playing the long game, we'll see, right?
What's the long game?
Well, we're not even, I mean, we're a year away from what? California? When is California?
The day that Chuy announced he was running for Congress and all these other candidates started coming in, that day, Bernie endorsed Chuy. Mm-hmm. And because Bernie did that, none of the other candidates could get a footing. Bernie didn't have to do that. He could have waited a week. And he would still be done a great thing. The very, very first rally that Bernie did for people running for Congress in 2018, the very first one, numero uno, was not in Vermont, was not in Brooklyn. We know where it was. It was in Chicago. First rally, Chuy Garcia. First one he did. Second one was a little bit up the road for Iron Stash.
Okay, so Bernie Sanders is a political animal, isn't he? He knows what he's doing. That's one of the things that occurred to me, is
sure.
He's been in the House and the Senate for a long time, for decades.
That's right. And, I mean, like when I say that he founded the Congressional Progressive Caucus, that's no small feat. I mean, you know, he got something going that was extremely meaningful and very, very, very important, and then was elected to be the chairman of it. By people who included Nancy Pelosi, by the way. She was not the powerful Nancy Pelosi she is today. She was, you know, she was a little bit of a power, but not certainly not a leader or a speaker. And she was in that, she was part of that caucus, and someone who was a Bernie Sanders ally.
Okay, tell me if I'm crazy. I have a theory that in the end, Tim Cook over at Apple, Jeff Bezos, and Jamie Dimon, in the end, will support Bernie. I know everybody's right now rolling their eyes and saying I'm crazy. Tim Cook has called for regulation. He has said, look, the privacy issues, we're going to do what we're going to do. You guys need to step in and regulate us because we need help here. Otherwise, if there's no government stepping in, we're going to go at any speed limit we want to. Step in. I think Bezos, you know, he raised the minimum wage when Bernie introduced the Stop Bezos Act. I think Bezos respected Bernie for that. I think Wall Street sees what's happening, and they're like a child going, Daddy, Mommy, discipline me. I think they're going to support Bernie. I think there are enough smart people on Wall Street who know that this is unsustainable for them.
I don't think there's any way they're going to support him during the primary. But if you mean that they're going to support him against Trump, I think that there will be, yes. I think the answer is yes, that those three will. And I think that there are people on Wall Street who will as well, although there will also be people on Wall Street who won't. If, you know, I have to guess, and I don't know these people, you know, I don't have anything more, any knowledge more than anyone else does about this, but I think that if status quo Joe is the Democratic nominee, that there'll be more Wall Street people that will support the Democrats in 2020. I think Wall Street very much wants status quo Joe. He's their guy. They don't want Bernie.
Yeah, let me push back.
If it is Bernie, are they going to go for Bernie over Trump? Many will and some won't.
Let me push back. You know more about this than I do. You've worked in the corridors of power over at Time Warner and Reprise. I suspect what Wall Street wants is action, any kind of action. Their job is not to make money for people. It's to make money off action, any transaction that's going on. That's in their best interest. So if Bernie comes in and there's a new Green New Deal and he's breaking up banks, he's breaking up the corporations, what sprinkles down are new IPOs, new corporations, new stocks. That's good for Wall Street.
Some people will see it that way, and other people will see, you know, I mean, conservatives are never going to see it that way. But, you know, there are people who are smart enough to realize that the things that Bernie, as well as AOC and others, are proposing are going to stimulate gigantic shifts of wealth, gigantic. And Wall Street, when there are shifts of wealth, Wall Street's always getting some of it shifted to them.
Right. It's in their best interest. Talk to me about impeachment. So up until reading Down with Tyranny this week, today, I had one idea about impeachment. My original idea was, you know what, just go slowly on this. Don't impeach. Let the voters decide. Then I started reading you about Jerry Nadler and George Stephanopoulos, and I realized, you know, the American people want somebody who means business. They want a party that means business. And if you have Bernie at the top of the ticket and you're impeaching Trump and you're going for blood and heads figuratively on a stick, the American people are going to respond to that. They're not going to respond to a party and a leadership that's going, well, maybe he broke the law, maybe he didn't. They want something definitive, and that's what you want.
Yes, and you know, if you watch the Nadler interview this over the weekend with Stephanopoulos on ABC TV, you saw that in the beginning of the interview, Stephanopoulos was trying to pin him down and make him say we're going to impeach him. You know, that's a decision that Nadler is not going to be able to make. That's a decision, although he may know what the answer is already, and maybe there is a timetable. But the person who's driving that and making the decisions on that is Pelosi. Pelosi will decide if and when. But at this point, Nadler, first of all, in that interview, he finally overthrew that moronic Pelosi, mantra that they've been saying, that we have to wait for Mueller. Well, that's insane. Mueller is part of the executive branch, and there's nothing in the Constitution about Mueller. It is the job, as many of Nadler's committee members have been telling him. I mean, that committee is full of, like, you know, very, very, very strong progressives, and they've been saying to him, hey, this is our job. This is what we were elected to do. We are here to investigate crimes. Did you see that quote that Ted Lieu gave me today? It was so awesome. I love it. I love the quote so much. I used it today, and then tomorrow, my first post in the morning, it's the title of the post. I'm going to read it. I have to pull it up on my computer, and I'm in a different room, but I'm walking over there now. Okay. Unlike last term, the House Judiciary Committee will actually conduct oversight over the executive branch. Instead of holding stupid hearings about why Republican legislators don't get enough likes on Facebook, we will be holding hearings on whether any crimes were committed by the executive branch officials and those within their orbit. Is that like poetry?
Yeah.
Lou is so amazing. This guy is just absolutely incredible. Likes on Facebook. I mean, yes, that's what the Republicans thought that the Judiciary Committee should be investigating last time. And that's what they wasted everybody's time doing. So now what Nadler was saying basically is that they are doing all of the things that you have to do before you open a formal investigation into impeachment. So there, in other words, today 81 letters went out asking for interviews, asking for, and some will be, you know, behind closed doors, others will be public, asking for documents. And they went to everybody from Donald Trump Jr. and Ivanka and Jared Kushner to Jeff Sessions, to Russians, to everyone who's been involved, you know, Weisselberg, everyone who's been involved with all of Trump's criminal activities in every sphere, anything that can point to reasons for him being impeached. 81 was the first day of letters going out. So you know, yes, that I thought was really, really great that Nadler did that, that his committee did that, Pelosi let him do that, and I was so excited when he went on TV and said, you know, that, you know, basically what I've been saying all along, that no, we're not waiting for Mueller. That's separate. Mm-hmm. We love him. We respect him. We'll work together with him. But, you know, it's a separate thing. He's doing one thing. We're doing another thing.
And the reason that's good to do, other than we're a nation of laws, supposedly, is the presidential election is heating up. The Democrats have to do what the Republicans would do, which is distract the White House, have them care more about going to prison than being reelected. It costs money and time to answer all these subpoenas. He's playing hardball with the Republican Party, which is exactly what the Republicans would be doing to the Democrats over a blowjob.
Yep, which they did over. Yes, that's right.
But the political expediency is taken into consideration by Pelosi. She's convinced that impeachment would backfire because of Clinton's impeachment, but they're not the same thing.
Exactly. And I don't know what she's thinking. I'm not sure. It might be what you just said, but I suspect down deep that she's just waiting for the right time to spring this thing. I mean, she let Nadler, I mean, Nadler's on a tight leash, really. He is. She, you know, Nadler did not get the job of chairman automatically. There was a vote on it, and she was the decider. She decided who was going to get that job. He got challenged by Zoe Lofgren, who is a Pelosi ally, supposedly, and there was some thought. You know, Zoe made this thing. Hey, I'm a woman. It's our turn to be chairman. And that was her thing. And you know, Pelosi could very well have gone along with her and probably have swung the chairmanship to Zoe. Mm-hmm. But, you know, she said to Nadler, I own you, right? He said, yes, you do, Madam Speaker. And boom, he was the chairman.
Okay.
But her to let Nadler go as far as saying, forget that we have to wait for Mueller thing. That came from Pelosi. We're waiting for Mueller. That was her brilliant strategy that has been a disgrace. She let him. Believe me, he did not come out of his words, out of his mouth, without her having approved that. She approved that. So that's a really, really good thing. And that made me think that she's got some kind of timetable in her mind for sticking it to Trump. You know, believe me, she wants him to suffer as much as you do, and much as I do, and as much as anybody who's listening to this show does.
So my question is about Bernie, and it's what are you and then me missing? I'm seeing now what you're seeing. I watched the rallies, and I'm seeing what a lot of people aren't seeing yet because they're not paying attention. They've got lives to lead. They're not obsessed with Bernie. But I'm seeing stuff because of you that I say to people, trust me, you're voting for Bernie. You may not think you're voting for Bernie, but the more you get to know Bernie, you're going to be voting for him. Trust me. Some people go, okay. And other people go, absolutely not. Absolutely not. These are Democrats. I would never, ever vote for Bernie. And I say, you will. You'll see. What do you think you're missing with Bernie? What's out there? Is it his not filing his taxes? Is Jane his wife?
No. It's just
Elroy. What about Elroy? Is he
a little tiny Hillary thing? We're at an event, and she purposely went out of her way to go and hug, kissy with Cory Booker and like, you know, become the ice queen as soon as she came anywhere near Bernie.
Well, he's cold to her. He said he will not be. I saw him on The View, and he said he won't be asking Hillary for any advice. So there's obviously
They asked him if he'll ask Hillary for advice, and he was honest with them. He didn't disparage her. In fact, he said nice things about her. Why would he ask her for advice? What's the advice? How to lose?
But what do you think? What is the unknown? Unknown, as Donald Rumsfeld would say. Is it his taxes? Is it the...
No, it's Hillary. It's the corporate Democrats. They loathe him. He's their enemy. He represents change. They represent the status quo. Anyone who wants things to stay the same doesn't want Bernie. Bernie wants real change. I mean, real change isn't like make-believe change. It's real change. It's not like a little incremental baby step. When he says that he wants a revolution... That's different from what someone like status quo Joe Biden wants. It's
right.
Not the same thing. They're not, you know, these people like Hillary, people like Joe Biden, they have more in common in some ways, not always, but in some ways they have more in common with Republicans than they do with Bernie.
There have been three revolutions in my lifetime. There was the Reagan Revolution. They called it a revolution. There was the Gingrich Revolution. The Contract for America was a revolution. He said this is a revolution. And
those were counter-revolutions.
But they called them revolutions, though.
Right, but they were really counter-revolutions. They were reactionary things that wanted to take a step backwards. Not a revolution is something that's moving forward.
Okay.
So, you know, they could call it whatever they want, but in reality, those were both of those two were counter-revolutions.
Okay, so when two white men like Reagan and Gingrich say this is a revolution, you automatically, the branding goes to 1776. Watching Bernie say this is a revolution, how is that going to play with the American people when Bernie calls for a revolution? Because a revolution... For Gingrich and Reagan means we're going to make money, you know, but when Bernie says this is a revolution, it's we're going to take money.
Look at who's supporting Bernie in the polling. I know you've looked at this polling. And if you break it down generationally, the older you go, the least likely someone is to vote for Bernie. That doesn't mean that no one who's over 70 is going to vote for Bernie. But when you compare Bernie to status quo Joe, that's where status quo Joe gets his support, is the very, very, very old. People who are, you know, closer to death.
Mm-hmm.
The people, and the younger you go, is the more people support Bernie. Like people under 40, if only people under 40 voted, you could just close up the election. You didn't have to have an election. You don't have to have a primary, and you don't have to have an election. Bernie is the president of the United States. But it's when you start getting beyond 60, then you start getting some problems because people who are like older like that are not necessarily not all. I mean, I'm 71, so I don't think I fit this by any means. But as you get older, you might start getting to think a little bit less about society and a little bit more about your own self and not wanting changes that are going to disturb the way things are. When you're older, you don't want you don't want turmoil. You don't want changes. You want things to just stay the way they are so you can die in peace. And people who are just thinking about dying in peace, they don't want Bernie. They don't want Trump either necessarily. But Biden is perfect for them. That's all he's thinking about also. I don't know why he's running.
If you're old and you look at Bernie, you think you're pragmatic. I've lived a long life. And it's great what Bernie says, but how is he going to hold them all together? You got the Jews hating the blacks and the Latinos hating the blacks and the gays.
Old people are like that and the Trump people are like that. But when you look at who is the base of the Democratic Party, the Jews do not hate the blacks and the blacks do not hate the Jews. It's a different world now. Young people don't see it that way anymore. And the divisiveness that has just riven America from the time that we were kids, that's not the way it is anymore.
For young people.
Yeah, for young people. Young people doesn't mean 15-year-olds. Young people means people basically under 40. You know, they're over this crap already. You know, we're a one country. We're Americans.
Right, right. Not being a young person, I watch Bernie, and I think this is a wonderful campaign. I'm voting for him. But I've been trained, I've been brainwashed to believe that once he's in office and that revolution takes hold, it turns into the Bolsheviks. It's not going to hold. Everybody will splinter off, and it turns into a Paddy Chayefsky screenplay. Do you worry about that?
No.
Not at all?
Not at all.
Okay, before you go, Sean King got up and spoke in Brooklyn. Brilliant. He's an African-American journalist and told the story of Bernie fighting for civil rights. And Senator Tina Turner, what is her name? I confuse her with Tina Turner.
Nina
Turner spoke in Chicago and Brooklyn.
She used to be a state senator from Ohio, and then she ran for statewide office and lost. So now she's running a Bernie group.
Okay. As an older
She runs our revolution, I think. Although I think she stepped away from running it, but she's involved with our revolution.
Okay. So before I get to my question, there was a African-American reverend in Brooklyn who got up and spoke at the rally on Saturday, and he screamed, "Burn, baby, burn," which was very clever, right?
Yeah.
Burn, baby, burn. You know, can you feel the burn, burn? And I kind of grimaced because I thought, I love that, but in terms of marketing, is it smart for an African-American to be screaming burn, baby, burn as an endorsement for...
Many people who are too dumb to understand that are the Trump people.
Mm-hmm.
They're not in Brooklyn, and they're not going to vote for Democrat anyway. They're going to vote for Trump. So I wouldn't worry too much about that. The people who are inspired by that burn, baby, burn, they get the joke. They get the pun.
Okay. So my last question to you is, I watched Spike Lee's commercials for Bernie. I heard all the I'm sorry?
Can I ask you a question? You usually say, I have a last question for you.
I've got a lot of questions to ask you.
No, that's okay. But I just want to know, do you edit out all the time that you say I have a last question for you?
No.
Actually, one last question for me?
Okay, this is the last question. Okay. Is it fair to say that the African-American community, without Hillary, is going to love Bernie more than they love the Clintons?
When?
When they find out.
He becomes president, or you mean during the primaries?
During the primaries, when they start finding out, when they start seeing the pictures of him being arrested.
I don't think that it's, well, I think that, yes, that's going to have some appeal, but I think that a lot of African-Americans who maybe didn't know what Bernie was all about last time and were sort of, you know, thinking, okay, well, we're loyal to the Clintons because they've been loyal to us and that's it. I think a lot of them now are seeing Bernie. And in some of the polling that I've seen, it's very interesting that Bernie is outpolling Booker, who is African-American, outpolling Kamala Harris, who claims she's African-American on some level, and outpolling Joe Biden, who thinks, you know, he's Obama.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I mean, Bernie, no, actually, I think Biden is doing a little bit better. So it was Biden getting the most African-American support, followed by Bernie, but very, very close, and then less for Kamala and Booker.
Yeah. A lot of people are telling me to take it easy on Bernie, to lay back, but I'm paying
attention. Why?
They think that it's a mistake for this show. They think it's not even-handed and that Bernie is deeply flawed. And
well, let's say nice things about Elizabeth Warren next week.
I like Elizabeth Warren.
Me too. I like her a lot. I think she's great.
But she's
I wish she would run for vice president with Bernie.
Yeah. Howie Klein is the founder and treasurer of the Blue America PAC, which raises money for progressive and socialists around the country. Go to him every day and read him over at Down with Tyranny. We'll get to Ed Rendell next week.
Oh, yes.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Russia, 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 Russia. The attorney general says I'm going to recuse myself. And I said, why the hell didn't he tell me that before I put him in? Russia, 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 Russia.
He asked Russia to go get the emails.
Russia, 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 Russia. Darling, is the wind blowing today? I'd like to watch television, darling. Russia, 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 Russia. Russia, please, if you can, get us Hillary Clinton's emails. Please, Russia, please.
You're listening to The David Feldman Show, you happy, self-actualized hump.
Jacki Schechner joins us from Los Angeles. She is the editor-in-chief of the Committee to Investigate Russia. Go to investigaterussia.org for all your Russian collusion needs. She is the expert on the Russian story. Nobody knows more about Russia than Jacki Schechner. Thank you for doing this.
Oh, my pleasure. Anytime.
Okay. A lot of my listeners are overwhelmed by everything.
Sure. And, I know the feeling.
Yeah. And then you throw Russia into the mix. Some of them have stopped following it. So I have
I hope not.
I know. Because they're overwhelmed and it's paralyzing.
You know what they should do? They should go to investigaterussia.org.
Yes, and they should support it financially as well.
Nobody. Well, that would be great. Yeah. But I'm happy if they just go and read it, because yes. What we try to do is aggregate all of the information and pick the stories that you need to know. So you don't have to feel overwhelmed. You can just go through what we've picked out for you, and it'll give you all of the pertinent information.
Yes, it's overwhelming. I think, and this is my question, I think the best way to serve my listeners is to break the story down to its constituent parts. And this is how I see the investigation, and I think it might make it easier for the listeners to view it through this prism. There's one, the Mueller investigation. When does he issue the report? That's the first prong. The Mueller investigation, and he's going to issue a report. I think it's coming up soon. Then there are the Mueller trials. Number three, there's the federal prosecutor from the Southern District of New York. That's separate from the Mueller investigation. And that's what they're doing on the judicial front. Then in the House and the Senate, the Democrats have the House. So you have Jerry Nadler, a Democrat. He's the chairman of the House Judiciary Committee. And then there's the great Elijah Cummings. He's chairman of the House Oversight Committee. That's where Michael Cohen was testifying. And then you have Adam Schiff. He's a Democrat, and he's the chairman of the House Intelligence Committee. And then the last two pieces are the Senate, where we have the Senate Intelligence Committee, which is chaired by Lindsey O. Graham. He's a Republican.
No, the Intelligence Committee is actually Richard Burr.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Yeah. The Judiciary Committee, Lindsey O. Graham.
Judiciary Committee is Lindsey Graham. Yeah.
Right. And then the Intelligence Committee is Dick Burr, as I call him, and he's a Republican. What are you laughing at? So that's what?
Everybody likes a good dick joke. Go ahead.
I didn't say anything. So that, I think, is everyone who is looking into this. And then you have the media and Jacki Schechner. So,
or as my father would say, what are you doing that Mueller isn't doing?
So let's start off with the Mueller investigation. I was going through my Kindle. You can pre-order the Mueller report.
Yeah, I don't know that that's a legit thing.
When is that coming out?
I don't know. I mean, I saw that somebody put that up on Twitter. That there was a pre-order the Mueller report. There was one through Amazon. I don't remember who that was by, and then another one was put up by the Washington Post, allegedly. I don't know if those are real or not. Mm-hmm. Nobody knows yet. I mean, there was some gossip that it was coming out last week, and then the Justice Department said no. I don't think anybody knows, and I think it's a really awful parlor game to try to guess what Mueller knows and when he's going to be done. Mm-hmm. I think that there are obviously there's a desire for it to be done sooner rather than later, but nobody really knows. He may be wrapping up because there have been some members of his team who have gone back to their previous jobs, so there's an indication that their work is done. I'm hoping it's soon, just because it feels like now would be a good time. But I don't think anybody truly knows the answer to that.
Right.
And there's a lot of components to it, and there's no knowing how much Mueller's finished and what he's still digging into.
Yeah. It feels like he could spend the next 50 years prosecuting everybody in Trump Tower. Where do you stop?
Yeah, I don't know. You know, his mandate was fairly specific in comparison, I would say, because his mandate is to investigate Russian interference in the election and possible coordination with the Trump campaign, and then any crimes that he uncovers in the course of that. Mm-hmm. So that's where he ends up with Manafort and Gates and Flynn and those guys. I don't know what the answer is going to be with regard to conspiracy or collusion. My assumption, based on everything that I read, I don't understand how you could possibly come out with any conclusion that doesn't mention conspiracy or cooperation or coordination or collusion or whatever you want to call it, because there has been so much evidence of those conversations and those interactions thus far. So to now come out and say, yeah, I don't see any sign of cooperation seems strange.
Right.
So to me, it seems like that will be inevitable, depending on who they end up indicting and how far up the food chain it goes. That's anybody's guess. So that's what it looks like. But you've got guys like Mark Warner, the ranking member of the Senate Intelligence Committee, and Representative Schiff, the now chairman of the House Intelligence Committee, saying that they've seen plenty of signs of conspiracy, cooperation, collusion. So
right, but they're not going to – they don't prosecute.
They don't prosecute. No, they just help investigate. And it looks like Schiff is taking the lead on digging – well, Maxine Waters digging into Deutsche Bank, but Schiff's committee taking the lead on possible money laundering. And I like that. That I think that that's something that, that needs to be done, and I'm glad that they're very much focused in on that.
So Maxine Waters would be chairman of the House Banking Financial Services?
Yeah, I think she's finance. Yeah, I think she's finance.
And she's a Democrat. Let's go back to Mueller and the Southern District of New York. If my listeners think they're overwhelmed, imagine how the Southern District of New York. I couldn't get out of bed in the morning if I had to go prosecute all these people. He's going to issue this report sometime in the near future. We don't know whether or not we're going to see it. But the Senate might subpoena it from the Justice Department, which is a constitutional issue that I shouldn't burden you with. What's going on? Oh, go ahead. You want to respond to that?
No, I was just going to say, so what's happened is the way it works is that Mueller has got to, and forgive me if I get too pedantic.
No, no, please.
I'm going to try and break it down, is that Mueller has to issue the report to the Attorney General, which now is William Barr. And William Barr has the authority to do with it as he pleases. And he is saying that he will summarize it and hand it off to Congress. And Congress is saying, no, we want to see the whole thing. We have the right to see it. The public has the right to see it. We want to see all of it. Mm-hmm. So it's going to become a battle to see how much William Barr ends up releasing to Congress and how much he ends up allowing to be made public. I don't think anyone in the Senate or the House is going to be pleased with just a William Barr summary, especially if there is an indication that something's being hidden in that process.
Right.
I also don't know how much of a Trump guy William Barr is or isn't. That's a tough thing to tell. I'm not a fan of William Barr's, and the fact that he wrote this extensive 19-page unsolicited memo to the Justice Department, essentially auditioning for the job to be Attorney General, it doesn't give me good feels. But at the same time, he worked with Robert Mueller before. They have a relationship. I would hope that there's some loyalty to the Justice Department, maybe to the rule of law.
He was an Attorney General, right?
He was an Attorney General before, but he also was responsible for a slew of pardons or approving a slew of pardons during the Bush administration, the first Bush administration when he served. So I don't know. I think there's a conflict there between his thought that there is a very limited extent to what the president can't do. He has a very wide view of executive powers. But I would also hope that there's an ingrained commitment to law and justice, I would hope. And I don't know how much credit we can or can't give him. I haven't seen any indication one way or the other than the evidence we've seen that he essentially auditioned to be Attorney General again. And that begs to question why. Why would you sign up to be a part of this administration at this point?
Right. The Southern District of New York is part of the Justice Department.
Correct.
And they're doing separate investigations that are linked to the Mueller investigation, but they're separate. Like the Trump Foundation, I believe, is being investigated by the SDNY, right?
Yeah, they're primarily in charge of the Michael Cohen stuff, too. That was one thing that got passed off to them, was the Michael Cohen, the hush money payments. The Southern District of New York has the authority to look into the Trump Organization and malfeasance in that regard and what they've done, if there's financial crimes that were committed as part of the Trump Foundation, the Trump Organization. So that's their purpose.
And Cohn said he didn't see any evidence. He suspects evidence of collusion. Had he seen evidence of collusion, then Mueller would have been more interested in him.
Well, this is what's so interesting, is the president's now getting up and saying, you know, the one thing Michael Cohen didn't lie about is he said there's no collusion. What Michael Cohen said was, I hadn't seen any direct evidence of collusion, but I have my suspicions. Mm-hmm. That's what he said. The full quote is that he personally hasn't seen any direct evidence, but he thinks that things are suspect.
And he heard a conversation between Roger Stone and Trump, and Stone reporting that he just got off the phone with Julian Assange. The leaks are coming.
Yes, yes. And that, to me, seems quite indicative of the fact that there was some collusion or conspiracy. Mm-hmm. At the very least, we know that the Trump campaign was more than willing to accept help from a foreign adversary. We have plenty of evidence of that, going all the way back to Don Jr.'s email saying, if it's what you say, I like it. I mean, we know he flat out emailed that he was more than happy to take help from a foreign adversary. At no point did anybody in the Trump campaign or on the Trump team call the FBI and say, we're really worried about Russian infiltration. And they were warned. They were warned that the Russians might try to take advantage. And not a single person called the FBI and said, hey, we're seeing signs of this. Mm-hmm. Not Michael Caputo when he and Roger Stone were approached by somebody that was offering information. Roger Stone himself never made that call. I think Hope Hicks was warned at one point. I mean, there's a lot of members of this administration, the Trump campaign, transition, all of it, who were warned that the Russians might be trying to do something, and not a single one contacted law enforcement. That, to me, tells you where their loyalties lie.
Do you ever wonder if perhaps the Trump campaign is guilty of 1,000 misdemeanors that are kind of inadvertent, stupid, and arrogant, but the real victim here is Trump, that he was played by Putin? Do you ever worry about that?
No, I don't. Because, I mean, yes, I think he is played by everybody, because I think that he's not very bright, and I think that he's easily manipulated. Mm-hmm. But I think that he knew exactly what was going on. I think he didn't care. I think this is somebody whose ego is so out of control, and whose narcissism and is so out of control, that it wouldn't dawn on him that he was somehow being played. But I don't think even if he was manipulated by somebody like Putin, he even really cared so much. Like, what he cares about is money and himself. And if whatever relationship he needed to have in that capacity was working to his benefit in some way, he would just spin it as it was beneficial financially to him.
Okay.
If that makes sense.
Yeah. Okay, so we've covered the Justice Department and their investigations mm-hmm. into Trump. On the state level, we're not really hearing about the attorney generals going after him quite yet. We heard hints of that, but that's kind of died down. Let's turn to the House Judiciary Committee, Jerry Nadler.
Mm-hmm.
What can
Nadler,
we expect?
Nadler.
Mm-hmm. If there's going to be an impeachment, it would come out of the House Judiciary Committee.
Yeah. The thing with impeachment that we have to keep in mind is that even if you get impeachment out of the House, you've got to get the Senate to vote on it. Mm-hmm. And when you've got Republican control in the Senate, you're not going to get that. So it would end up being, you know, you can impeach in the House, but then shot down in the Senate. So I don't think it behooves the Democrats in the House to move forward with impeachment until they know that they can get any kind of majority in the Senate. And so I think that that's why they're not interested in moving forward necessarily at this moment. I think the idea is make the evidence so overwhelming and irrefutable that you can't you can't turn it down once it gets to the Senate. And I think my guess is that's the goal, is that there's no rush to impeach until they know that it'll actually make a difference.
And we're seeing movement in the House Judiciary Committee towards impeachment this week.
Well, there's definitely, I would say, a move towards oversight. And that's the 80 some odd letters that the House Judiciary Committee just sent out asking for information, because they want to probe obstruction of justice. They want to probe potential misconduct. They want to figure out if there's corruption. They want to know what's going on. And it's 2 years that there was no oversight when the Republicans were in control. Right. So now the Democrats, and of course, the scream from the Republican side and from the president and his allies is that it's overreach. But it's not. It's oversight. It just should have been happening a long time ago. That's what Congress is supposed to do. They're co-equal branches of government. So when Congress is just a rubber stamp and just says, go ahead, do whatever you want, there's no oversight. That's what the president's been used to. Now that the Democrats, thank goodness, are exercising the power that they have to put in a system of checks and balances on this administration, it's going to look like a lot, because you're going from zero to 60. Mm-hmm. you're ramping up really quickly, because it's been 2 years of nothing up until now.
Right. Is it Nadler or Nadler?
I think it's Nadler.
You know more than I do. So Nadler, huh? Nadler. Jerry Nadler tomorrow.
I could be wrong, but he
could take a vote tomorrow and recommend impeachment, and he would probably get those votes. But it would be
probably, because they have a Democratic majority. But it doesn't. That then doesn't go anywhere.
Right.
Right. It gets to the Senate and it dies.
Right.
And so what's the point, right? So it's just an exercise. It's a futile exercise. And then you don't do it again, because it's going to feel futile. So you wait. You wait until you have an overwhelming amount of evidence.
Right. The Senate and the House, those committees have political power. They can get enough information out there to get Trump impeached. And then they also have the oversight that puts the truth out there.
Yes.
And through that process, they can get people to lie before Congress. And if you lie before Congress, as they're trying to get the truth out, then you can be brought up on criminal charges, because that is a felony.
Well, yeah, perjury. And even if you're not sworn in, lying to Congress is illegal. So, they can end up getting them on those charges. I mean, one of the things that Michael Cohen is going to jail for is lying to Congress about the length of the Trump Tower Moscow negotiations. It's part of what he's in trouble for. Mm-hmm. And so I think that they've also ended up, they're going to have the same issue with Don Jr., who they think was not honest about his testimony before Congress. I think there's a whole bunch of other people that probably didn't tell the truth either. So it just seems like it just seems like there are a whole lot of people who are going to have some explaining to do.
The House Oversight Committee is chaired by Elijah Cummings, who,
yes,
his closing statement was one of the most powerful things I've ever seen.
Oh, I thought he handled himself beautifully. I thought that entire trial was, especially what was going on with Jim Jordan and Mark Meadows and the Republicans trying to pull the whole thing off course. They even tried to stop it from happening in the first place. So I think Cummings was gracious. I thought his closing statement was beautiful. I thought the way that he handled the entire day was perfect. And he left. I think he left a good feeling that he was going to get the job done. Mm-hmm. He wasn't suffering fools graciously, and that we had a grown up in charge, thank God, again. And that was nice. So I think everybody would be well suited to follow that example.
Yeah. I'm not playing devil's advocate here. I'm going to defend Mark Meadows and Jim Jordan.
Oh, God. Okay. Go ahead.
I suspect, not knowing anything, that Elijah Cummings sat down with Mark Meadows and Jim Jordan and said, I expect you guys to find every hole in the Democratic Party's line of reasoning and pick at it, because that's their job. If you're going to arrive at the truth, Mark Meadows and Jim Jordan are kind of obligated to do everything they can to question what we believe to be the truth, right? And I thought they did a poor job doing it. They came across as foolish, which further moves our side along. But they had to do that. Otherwise, they kind of validated our case against the president by trying everything possible to discount Cohn's testimony. That's kind of their responsibility.
Here's the problem with that. You can discount Cohen as much as you want, but ask some questions about the president. I mean, he's bringing forth information. Probe into that information. You know, how can we believe that that's true? What evidence do you have that that's true? Why would you say something like that? I mean, they weren't the least bit interested in any of the information that was coming forward about the alleged misdeeds of the president. Mm-hmm. And so I feel like you can do what you want to do to try to discredit Michael Cohen. But are you not the least bit interested? I mean, to me, there's a better way of doing that. And I think that they turned it into a circus. And the fact that they had no interest in knowing what the president of the United States may or may not be doing was very telling to me. Mm-hmm. I don't have any sympathy for Michael Cohen. I think he's getting exactly what he deserves. I don't know that he told the truth in his testimony in its entirety. There's some indications that perhaps he wasn't entirely honest. And I would have to say that after a lifetime of being that kind of guy, all of a sudden turn a corner or, right. You know, claim that you found Jesus or, right. You know, whatever it is, that all of a sudden you've had your come to Jesus moment and you've all of a sudden become the most honest guy in the world. I find that hard to believe. I'm skeptical. But I do think there's truth to some of the stuff that he said. And I think that what's nice is that he laid out a roadmap for other investigators to follow. And that's what's happening behind closed doors with the Senate Intelligence Committee prior to his testimony and now with the House Intelligence Committee the day after and this coming week.
Right. What didn't you trust about Cohen's testimony?
I think he wanted a job in the White House. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. I think it is no question. I mean, I've heard it now. There's, you know, multiple sources who said, look, you know, he made it abundantly clear he wanted to follow Trump to the White House. Mm-hmm. So I think that was true. I don't know. I don't think many of the stories he told were untrue. I think that Trump is a racist. I think we've seen plenty of signs of that. I think he's a con man. I think he's a cheat. I think he's a liar. I think he's a grifter. I mean, this is all stuff that we've known, not even when he started running for president. We knew this about him when he was a reality TV guy.
Right.
I mean, we knew this when he was a real estate. He was a racist when he was in real estate. Mm-hmm. So this is not new information. But it's helpful that somebody who's was super close to him, and has insight from the inside validating what we already know. I think that's helpful.
Alan Weisselberg.
Mm-hmm.
Who is Alan Weisselberg? And am I correct in assuming that he's just flipped and turned everything
no.
up?
No, wrong. I'll tell you why. Alan Weisselberg is the CFO for the Trump Organization. He's been with the organization since the days of Fred Trump. He actually is not cooperating.
Really?
He's not. He got immunity to testify before a grand jury in the Southern District of New York's investigation, but he is not fully cooperating. And that's something that people are getting wrong when they write this up, is that he did accept immunity to testify before the grand jury, but he is not cooperating. By everything that I've read, he's not a full cooperating witness. He did not flip, and he is defending the Trump Organization, and he's still defending Trump.
In the back of my mind, I'm thinking Weisselberg went in, said to Mueller, what do you need to know? Here are the books. Because Weisselberg can end up going to prison forever.
Yeah, I mean, you would think that he would turn, but what I read recently was that he actually was granted immunity for that grand jury testimony in the SDNY investigation, but he has not agreed to full cooperation, and that he's still defending the Trump Organization.
Wow. Okay. Yeah. And finally, let's turn to the Senate. You've got Lindsey O. Graham as chairman of the Judiciary Committee, and you've got Richard Burr, chairman of the Senate Intelligence Committee. We're not going to see anything out of the Senate in terms of investigation, are we? Are they still looking into it?
I think Burr and Warner are still looking on the Intelligence Committee, and I have faith in Mark Warner. I don't know. It seems like he and Burr have seen the same stuff, and they've come to different conclusions. So I'm not sure what's going to come out of that committee. They've been bipartisan so far and worked together well so far. It's just unclear what that final product's going to look like. But they're still interviewing people. And as far as the Judiciary Committee is concerned, I had a lot of faith in Dianne Feinstein because she was actively pursuing some interesting lines of inquiry, especially when it comes to the NRA, back before that was really making big news. But now I worry, now that it's not Chuck Grassley and it's Lindsey Graham, because Graham has had this weird sudden allegiance shift towards Trump. and he hasn't been. You would have hoped that he would have followed in the vein of John McCain, considering mm-hmm. there was so much conversation about how good of friends they were. But instead, after McCain's passing, he became a very strong Trump ally and defending Trump at every turn. And it just makes me wonder what kind of compromise there is out here there on him, because the way he's behaving is wildly suspicious. And I worry about what he'll do with the Judiciary Committee. The nice thing is that on the Senate side, there is the Intelligence Committee that's still working, and there are some really strong members of the Judiciary Committee on the Democratic side. But I think that the best we're going to hope for is what comes out of the House Intelligence Committee. And I know that Adam Schiff, as the chairman, is super engaged in this, as is Eric Swalwell, Jackie Speier. I mean, there's a lot of members of that committee who are very much interested in picking up where Devin Nunes dropped off and allowing that committee to do the full investigation. And that's where I think we're going to get the most meat on the bone.
Lindsey Graham is kind of curious. The audience knows what the compromise would be. I read an interview with him in the New York Times. We all know the compromise. Putin mm-hmm. doesn't need to lord it over him. I think Lindsey Graham has daddy issues. I think with McCain gone, Trump has become the surrogate father, and Lindsey O. Graham keeps talking about in this interview in the Times how honored he is that the president of the United States keeps calling him and asking for advice. I think Trump is used to taking weak men and manipulating them.
Yeah, I don't know what it is. It's beyond me. I mean, there are people who get sucked into the Trump orbit. I don't find him interesting or charismatic or charming, or like he's not particularly wise mm-hmm. or so. I don't get it. Like, it's beyond me. I can understand if there's a leader with great charisma where you can fall under that spell. Donald Trump doesn't strike me as the kind of person that's anything but utterly transparent. So to me, when these men end up falling for the flattery coming from Donald Trump, and it's been happening for years, look at all of these people who get sucked into his orbit and then just orbit him indefinitely. I don't get it.
Well, there is a psychological need for a certain type of man who is missing something, like Michael Cohen was missing something. Lindsey Graham is missing something. And Trump is a predator. He can spot mm-hmm. them a mile away. He simultaneously praises and beats these guys up. I mean,
They take it. That's
well, they
the crazy
want it,
part.
But they want it.
That's weird.
Yeah, you're not a man. You're not a man, and you're not missing something. There is this quality, certain men want to be praised and beaten up at the same time, because they want.
Isn't that what a dominatrix is for?
Well, that's why they do so well in Washington. It's the imposter syndrome. Lindsey O. Graham is an imposter, and Michael Cohen is an imposter. They know that they're not complete. Trump can smell that out because he's a predator, and mm-hmm. he keeps them in his orbit by praising them and humiliating them.
And then beating them down. Yeah, I can see that.
I do a radio show with Ralph Nader, and Ralph Nader says, I don't do mood swings. He doesn't do mood swings. When people ask him, do you feel bad that the Trump administration is undercutting all your contributions? He says, I don't do mood swings. You just keep moving forward.
Mm-hmm.
Here's one thing about Trump. He is the worst president in my lifetime. I want him impeached. I want him in prison. But he is an inspiration. I watched him at CPAC last week coming back from Vietnam after the talks failed, after his own attorney just
mm-hmm. yeah.
spilled the beans. And then there he is for 2.5 hours in front of CPAC putting on the greatest show. You know, it's pretty impressive. It's yeah. pretty impressive.
I don't know. I think when you're a raging narcissist, the lure of just getting up on stage and vomiting words is I don't know. I mean, it's not I know what you're saying. Like, there's an impressiveness to the staying power of it. But I just think that he's so detached from reality, and he gets such a thrill out of being up in front of people and spewing whatever he wants and not being criticized for it. He feeds on it. And so I don't know. It's like being impressed with someone who has severe mental illness and not the kind that you should be compassionate about. Uh-huh. Like, This is an evil person. This is a mean person. This is not somebody whose behavior you ever want to emulate in any way. This is not somebody who's setting a moral, ethical standard for our children. So I don't know. I mean, who knows what sort of enhancements he's using in terms of, yes. There's been a lot of rumor about how he keeps going like that. I mean, this is a man who has a terrible diet, no fitness habits. By all means, he should have been dead 20 years ago. And somehow
the money he owes the Russian mafia loan, he should be dead 20 years ago.
Right? Yeah. I was worried. I will tell you, I was a little worried that Michael Cohen wasn't going to make it to his testimony.
What about that? I mean, do you feel?
I don't know. I worry about that. I worry about, what, I mean, not that I worry like, oh my gosh, what if something happens to him? But there is part of me that thinks that, Paul Manafort should have a food taster for a while, and Michael Flynn and Michael Cohen, because you just read about all of these suspicious deaths that are somehow linked to Putin, and you wonder what he'll go to. I mean, he won't stop at anything to protect himself and his oligarch. So it's interesting to me. I mean, I keep waiting for that sudden heart attack to happen.
Yeah. Jacki Schechner is the editor-in-chief of the committee.
On that uplifting note.
Yeah, well, you don't listen to my show. That is uplifting for my listeners. Are you kidding? Jacki Schechner is the editor-in-chief of the committee to investigate Russia. Go to investigaterussia.org every day. This stuff is complicated, and Jacki Schechner knows more about Russia than Robert Mueller does. I guarantee you.
No, I just want to make it easy for people to understand. That's really my goal, is that you got other stuff to do. You got other priorities, but you still want to know what's going on. That's what we do. I send out every evening I send out a newsletter. And if you just read that, it helps keep you up to date. So.
Yes. You do it objectively. You deal with the
facts. Yeah.
Okay, on a visceral level, if you're sitting with my mother and my sister and me and playing the parlor game that we do, who do you hate the most? Maybe you can't answer this, but it changes each week. On a visceral level.
Oh, I mean, I despise everything about Donald Trump.
The people around him, who this week do you want to see frog marched? I'll give you my answer this week.
Oh, I think Don Jr.
Yes! Correct answer. Ding, 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 ding. For the hunting. Just for the hunting.
Oh, yeah. I'm disgusted with Ivanka, too. But, they're all shady and terrible. I mean, they're just terrible people. There's one thing to disagree with somebody based on your political lean, and I understand that. You can have different solutions to problems and different beliefs about how problems should be solved. But I don't believe you get credit for being a terrible person, like a fundamentally terrible person. Mm-hmm. And Donald Trump is a fundamentally terrible human being, and he's raised terrible children.
Yes.
So he hasn't even raised them. I don't even think he had any part in,
right.
Who knows? Ivana says she did it all. So, but I think these are not good people. These are not people who have kindness in their heart.
Instead of going to prison, I would like to sentence the three children to a week on Jeopardy. that to me. Jacki Schechner, can you stand on the line for 1 second?
Sure, you got it.
Thank you.
Today we say to the pharmaceutical industry that you will no longer charge the American people the highest prices in the world for prescription drugs. The result being one out of five Americans cannot afford to buy the medicine their doctors prescribe. How crazy is that? Whether they like it or not, the greed of the drug companies is going to end. We're going to lower drug prices in America.
You're listening to the David Feldman radio program, You Sad Pathetic Hump.
Today, the doctor we all know is Jay. He's calling in from far away. You'll want to hear what he will say. Some good advice he will relay. Make all your troubles go away. Dr. J. Sutay is here to stay. He tells his jokes cut. He's a comedian. He fixes children, the sick and needy ones. I'm Dr. J's a pediatrician. Dr. J is in the house.
Let's go to one of the Windsors. I believe it's South Windsor, Connecticut.
South Windsor, David. How you doing?
Dr. J. Sutay has joined us. You are the hardest working pediatrician in comedy. We'll talk about your dates coming up in a little while. On this show, I always ask you about the anti-vaxxers.
Yes.
And it seems to be getting worse. You told me before we started that the measles are coming back, and I'm not talking about the rock group. I'm talking about
the real measles.
The real measles.
Yeah, they came out with the measles, mumps, and rubella vaccine in 1963 when there were 500 deaths a year and like thousands, tens of thousands of hospitalizations for the measles. Came out with the vaccine in 1963. Year 2000, you know how many cases of measles we had in the United States by the year 2000?
How many?
0.0. It was declared eradicated by the CDC. And then, you know, in 98, the article by that doctor from England that said that there was a Wakefield, Dr. Wakefield, who claimed to show a link between MMR vaccine and autism in a group of only 12 children, and eventually his paper was retracted, and they found that he falsified his data, and he even lost his Great Britain medical license. And yet, the tragedy of that continues, so that now I think it's 12 or 13 different states are now having epidemics of measles outbreak. I just read in the paper today, public health officials in Boston are warning of a possible measles exposure after an individual with a confirmed case of the disease traveled from New York City to Boston and then on to New Hampshire. So, yeah. So if you took a bus or a train from New York to Boston and Boston to New Hampshire a couple days ago, you might want to check with your doctor. So the problem is people who are using wrong data to back up not vaccinating their kids. I came up with a new joke. I tried it out this weekend, an anti-vaxxer joke. I say, so where are my anti-vaxxers at? And no one would ever clap. I said, no, I know you don't want to admit it in public. I get it. I said, or maybe anti-vaxxers don't get out much because their kids are sick all the time.
Is it autism? Is it a fear of your child being poisoned?
I think that part of the reason that these things happen is everybody's a conspiracy theorist. And now with social media, all of these, you know, fake news, false stories can spread like wildfire. And, you know, if you look on Facebook, one of the articles I said that the top 12 vaccine-related Facebook groups are all anti-vax. Nothing by like the American Academy of Pediatrics or anything. We don't even hit the top 25. So,
who is the most respected anti-vaxxer out there? Jenny McCarthy,
or isn't Robert Kennedy heading up a committee for Trump? I think it's Robert Kennedy Jr. and Jenny McCarthy are probably the two-headed monster of it. And the one from the Teen Moms, the one that shows such good judgment to be a teen mom, is also not vaccinating her child. So, you know, those are the spokespeople for this. And screw the fact that I went to medical school residency and I've been in practice 25 years. Believe the Teen Mom.
It's too bad about Robert Kennedy, because a friend of mine is very involved with autism and trying to come up with a cure and take care of the kids who are suffering from it, especially.
And, Darla Shine, the wife of President Trump's communications director. Bring back our childhood diseases. They'll keep you healthy. That was what she had recently tweeted.
So she's for measles.
Yeah. Basically, if you're against vaccines, you are for measles.
But did they say it's good for kids to get the measles?
No. I mean, kids can have, I think the most frightening possibility is that it can rot your testicles. Nobody wants orchiditis. I mean, if you told the men that their kids could have, you know, rot their balls off with the measles, I think that they'd have a little more voice in the decision, don't you think?
I don't know. Maybe
they wouldn't want to go along with just what mom mom has to say. So
I would assume most of the anti-vaxxers aren't they kind of very religious? Yeah. Trump supporters who believe their testicles are rotten at birth, right? Aren't they?
There you go. Every year, 4 million people would get the measles before 1963.
Wow.
It's just amazing that we've let this happen. You can get deaf, you can be blind, you can have dead balls, you could have encephalopathy where your brain gets infected. So there are a lot of things that could turn out bad, but not many things that have been proven to, you know, be side effects worthy of this large number of people not getting their kids vaccinated.
If you take autism out of the equation, would anti-vaxxers still exist?
It's a good question. I mean, there's always somebody that's going to have I just don't remember there. You know, I started my practice in 93, and I don't remember this becoming a huge issue until closer to 1998, 2000. And now it's a daily thing. I have to deal with, you know, people who are deciding not to do it. And they say, well, we don't want to expose our, you know, our kids to germs or pathogens too early. And I just remind them, I said, well, what do you think he was exposed to as he passed through your uterine canal?
You filthy.
Filthy.
No.
That's right. That's right. God knows what's in your.
What's
at least not, at least there's a label of ingredients on the vaccines here. And possible side effects are listed as well.
Well, what are the side effects?
For the most part, it's not too bad. It's a little bit of soreness at the injection site. You sometimes can get a lacy rash a week or 7 to 10 days after you get it with a low-grade fever. But, you know, strong or bad reactions are really quite rare. Hmm.
And is there mercury in?
No, none of the vaccines that we routinely give kids have mercury in them, with one exception. Flu vaccine, if they're using pre-filled syringes, those are mercury-free. But if they're using multi-dose vials, which we have to go to sometimes when there's a shortage, they have the thimerosal as a preservative in there. But that's already been shown not to be any link to autism. I mean, when I started in practice in 93, I mean, there was a lot of mercury in the vaccines, very little autism. And since we took mercury out of the vaccines, we've got a lot of autism. You know, maybe mercury protects you from autism. I don't know.
Are we seeing more autism because there's more autism, or are we seeing more autism because we're able to diagnose it?
That's a good question, and I think it's probably a combination of both, which is why the numbers have increased so rapidly. But, you know, I certainly can tell an autistic kid, and, you know, by 12 to 24 months, I'm going to have a pretty good idea if he's a little different than the rest of the group. But the things are that happen now are, you know, kids that go through normal development and, you know, they get screened for autism. They pass all the screens and now they're 10 years old. And, you know, now you get educators involved with them. Well, if they don't have ADD and they're, you know, behaving this way, then they, you know, do testing. And, you know, we're finding some undiagnosed, quote unquote, autistic kids with Asperger's, you know, in mid elementary school aged.
Right. I'm thinking back to when I had my babies and how terrified I was. And when you say there's a spot of mercury in some flu vaccines, I would immediately be terrified of giving my kid that.
Do you give your kid salmon? Do you give your kid fish, swordfish? Do you give your kid fish?
Well,
I'm just saying.
Yeah.
I'm just saying. And, you know, the real way, or the easiest way to get mercury poisoning is through breathing it in, because it's a vapor at room temperature. So if you drop or break a mercury thermometer in a carpet and you don't get it all out, well, it leaches into the air over a long period of time, and that can slowly give you mercury toxicity. So it's not really what you eat. That the kind of mercury you eat is not necessarily as bad as what you breathe in, something like that. And then, you know, the amount in a vaccine, you'd need to have like 100,000 vaccines to have enough mercury for it to be consequential.
Are these anti-vaxxers stupid people who don't like being made to feel stupid?
No, their kids are special. You know, they're like Superman. The power of the sun is all we need.
Where is the intellectual undergirding I mean, if you say Bobby Kennedy Jr., I think, okay.
Robert Kennedy Jr., or what's his name? I had the name a minute ago. I wrote it down. But Robert F. Kennedy.
Yeah. My friend spoke to him 15 years ago, and he was saying, no, there's no link. Now he's come around. But to be fair or unfair to Bobby Kennedy Jr., I don't know how his mental health is these days, quite frankly.
Well, I would question it just on the base that he doesn't trust science, you know. I don't understand. I don't have a good explanation why a population of people don't want to willingly take our science juice and let us inject it into their kids' bodies. I don't understand.
I could see myself saying, you know, I know this is irrational, doctor, but I just, you know, I'm afraid of giving my kid this vaccine. What do you say to the patients?
Try to convince them that things are researched, and I give them all the websites where they can go to do their own due diligence and not just go home and Google, you know, childhood vaccinations. You know, go to some of the more reputable sites and do your research. But I will tell you, you're going to find more reasons to give it than to not give it.
Yeah.
And the danger of the vaccine versus the danger of the disease is incomparable. So.
And now the law is you can't send your kid to a school unless the child has had his vaccine.
With certain exceptions, some states have religious exemptions. Some states have philosophical exemptions. So it depends on what state you're in. And, you know, California had a pretty liberal, you know, if you don't want your kid to get the vaccine, you don't have to. But then 2015, they had that huge measles outbreak at Disneyland out there, and that spread like wildfire. And now in California, it's a very narrow you basically have to have a medical reason, basically allergy to the vaccine to be exempt from it.
And what are we looking at if you are vaccinated? Are you susceptible then if there's an outbreak?
Well, you are. If there's an outbreak and you have, the last one we got was probably at the age of one. And, you know, it's supposed to last a lifetime. But part of the thing you count on is that everybody else is getting vaccinated. So the chances of you coming in contact with it are very small. So the combination of your own immunity and the immunity of the herd around you is what protects you. So, you know, we're putting, immunocompromised people, elderly people at risk because the younger ones aren't being vaccinated as much.
What is a booster shot? As a child, I remember the booster shot being the most painful of all the shots.
The tetanus shot, get a tetanus shots as DPTs as a baby. Then you turn 11 and you haven't had one in a while, so you get a DT, and that one hurts like a motherfucker. And kids know about that because they all talk about it at school. Try to use a snow job on an 11-year-old. They already know what's coming.
What is a booster shot?
It's just you get a series when you're a baby, and then as you get older, certain ones have to have like a boost. You know, has to get a little more taste of the antigen to make sure that it's going to last forever. So, you know, like they get DPT, Hib, and pneumococcal at 2 months, 4 months, 6 months, but then you get a booster of pneumococcal at a year, and then you get a booster of DPT at 15 months.
What are the pneumococcal? Is what, tetanus?
No, tetanus is tetanus.
What's pneumococcal?
Is bacterial. Uh-huh. So you have the DPT, which is diphtheria, pertussis, whooping cough, and tetanus.
Okay.
And then you have Hib, which is a bacteria that causes meningitis, and pneumococcal, which is a bacteria that causes meningitis. And then we also give the rotavirus vaccine, which is for the viral intestinal bug where kids shoot it out of both ends at the same time. Never a pretty sight.
And how new are these vaccines? In other words,
I mean, we got DPTs.
Did our parents?
I doubt the parents got DPTs, but that was when they were trying to eradicate smallpox, so they had other things on their mind. But, you know, and we got vaccinated against diphtheria, pertussis, tetanus, polio, and then measles, mumps, and rubella. The new ones, you know, since I've been in practice, the chickenpox vaccine came out in the mid-90s. Hib came out in the early 90s. Prevnar came out in the late 90s. We've had rotavirus around for probably 10 or 15 years. Then hepatitis B, hepatitis A, they've been around. and then HPV if they elect to get the human papillomavirus.
So there's a lot of new vaccines that are being given to children.
More than what you and I got, yeah.
Okay. And are we getting these vaccines, adults? Are we getting them as well?
Well, they recommend if you had chickenpox as a kid that you get the shingles vaccine. You can get that. That will protect you from getting shingles because if you had wild-type chickenpox, the virus lives in your spinal nerves, and then it can come out as shingles as you're older if you're immunosuppressed.
So I guess my question is, why are children getting all these vaccines,
well, no,
but not adults?
Pneumococcal, now they give to adults. People over 55, smokers, they get the pneumococcal vaccine. People with emphysema, diabetes, things like that.
But these are people who are already sick. But I'm just talking about our general population of adults.
Yeah, you should get a tetanus shot, you know, DT every 10 years because they're only good for 10 years. So as an adult, we tend to wait until we step on our next nail to get that booster shot. But
just to get inside the head of an anti-vaxxer, if you take our general adult population that's healthy,
right,
they have not gotten the same number of vaccines that kids under the age of five have gotten.
Well, yeah, because these were they were culled out by the herd because when they were younger, if they were healthy enough not to catch Hib meningitis or pneumococcal meningitis or diphtheria, pertussis, tetanus, they survived. And the ones that didn't had – I mean the statistics are amazing, the deaths that are prevented by these vaccines.
Okay, so if I didn't
get – it sounds like the anti-vaxxers are depending on us all immunizing our kids so their kids won't get it because they're not vaccinated. But at the same time, we depend on the anti-vaxxers vaccinating their kids so that if we have a health issue, we're on chemotherapy or we were on immunosuppressive drugs, that we need them to have their kids vaccinated so that we won't catch something. So, sometimes it's public good,
Right. I'm just trying to understand this. So name one vaccine our kids are getting, but we didn't get as adults.
But you also need to remember, too, that the things the kids are getting shots against are largely diseases of childhood. I mean, adults typically didn't get diphtheria and whooping cough. And once you had it as a kid, you built up natural immunity to these things, so you didn't catch it again. But you had to be a strong and hardy stock in order to survive the whooping cough, or you died as an infant.
Diphtheria. I wasn't given a diphtheria vaccine. It was around. My parents just wanted me to get sick. No, they didn't have diphtheria vaccines back then?
I think it was all diphtheria, pertussis, and tetanus from at least my lifetime. So that's 55 years. So that's 64. I mean, we really started to hit high gear once the MMR came out in 63. We already had polio. DPT was already out before MMR. And then the early 90s, they hit their stride with the hepatitises. In fact, I was a resident 90 to 93. I saw kids come into the emergency room sick as shit with Hib meningitis and pneumococcal meningitis. Kids who lost their hearing or were blinded or, lost a limb because of the infection from it. So, I saw these things and I know what the extreme could be if kids are under vaccinated and
So if I didn't get a diphtheria shot as a kid,
right,
chances are I might have been exposed to it, but
right,
I had
natural protection.
I had certain
antibodies. Yeah, you would, if you had yourself tested for diphtheria antibodies, you might be positive,
which means I was exposed to it and my white blood cells were able to take it on.
And generated a protective antibody for it if you were exposed to it again.
Some people who didn't get the vaccine
died
because they didn't have something.
Right.
I see. And the argument that I've heard about the Spanish flu, which we're coming up on the 100th.
1918,
so it's 101 years old. Happy birthday.
People should read about that because that is scary. It's scary because of the confluence of events that made that huge. It was like people traveling back and forth from Europe because of the war and everything. It was just a shitstorm of stuff that all came together. And that was just traveling by boat. Imagine how quickly a novel flu would spread now that we've got the ability to move people around in a day by airplane. I mean, if something like that happened now, I don't think they could contain it.
People say that my grandparents were made of sturdy stock because of the Spanish flu, that
because they survived it.
Now, is that true, or were they just lucky?
Either they were strong, healthy stock and survived it because of a very good immune system, or they have some kind of natural protection so that the virus couldn't infect them. But every family lost one or two family members during the flu epidemic of 1918. It's amazing. So everyone was protected. Every home had the flu in it. You either survived it or you had some kind of natural immunity to it. We lost more people from the flu in 1918 than we did in all the wars last century.
If you were to look at somebody who is 104 years old,
all right,
they would have the Spanish flu antibody in their
yes,
blood.
Right. Yeah, probably have it they probably have it because their body would get it. And even if they had a natural protection against getting infected with that, their body would still respond to it. So yeah, I would say that is absolutely true.
That's fascinating. That's fascinating.
And my grandparents, both my grandmother and my grandfather, who passed in the late 90s, but, you know, they each had a sibling that passed away from the flu of 1918. It's a great book called The Flu. It's by Gina Culotta, who used to do book reviews for or the health editor for New York Times. Gina with a Culotta. I could say Culotta. It's probably Culotta. But it's called The Flu, and it's a great read about the influenza epidemic. And you know what's funny? I didn't learn about the influenza epidemic until one night I was, you know, probably in practice maybe 20 years ago, flipping around the channels, and PBS had a special on this flu. And I like viruses, and listen to it. I'm saying my grandparents were alive during that, but they've never mentioned any. It was so bad, nobody ever talked about it, David. It was so bad, they would bring their dead out to the street in the morning, and they would pick them up in trucks or wagons and stuff.
And did they know what it was at the time?
Yeah, I think they knew it was an infection, but we didn't even have antibiotics there. So a lot of people don't die from the virus, the flu, but they get so sick from the flu that, like, pneumonia takes over, bacterial infections can occur. And, we lost Luke Perry today, for God's sake. That was a stroke, though.
That was a stroke, yeah. So let's talk before you go. We also lost Brody Stevens, a great comic, a friend of
the show. I've heard wonderful things about him. I never had the pleasure of meeting him.
Yeah. I don't really like to talk about suicide on this show.
It's probably a good idea.
Because I think my listeners are already suicidal.
They're teetering on the edge if they're right. Listening to this podcast, though.
My concerns about discussing suicide is in a culture that is decaying, as is ours, we tend to romanticize suicide. We seem to be very forgiving of it and very understanding of it, as we should be.
Yeah.
So I want to tread lightly here. There's an epidemic of suicide in this country, and when people pay lip service to people suffering from mental illness, they'll say, call the 1-800 number. If you know somebody who is depressed or you fear might commit suicide, call this number. And everybody is okay then. We did due diligence. But as a nation,
public service announcement.
But as a nation, we're not doing due diligence, are we? In terms of accessibility to mental health care, accessibility to the drugs we need to fight off depression. When we do an autopsy after somebody commits suicide, we'll check his bloodstream, but we won't check his insurance. I'm being serious.
Yep.
I would like to know, when somebody commits suicide, was that person
mental health help available to him?
Yes. Could he or she afford the pills that were prescribed? When you do an autopsy on a suicide victim, I want to know what their health insurance was.
It's an interesting thing to look at. I have not heard about that, to see if people without health insurance are more likely because they don't seek help. That's an interesting take. I mean, we do suicide. We do a questionnaire. It's called the PHQ-9. We do it for all our patients yearly from 12 to 21, just as a screen. And it, you know, if the kids answer it honestly, it's a pretty good screen, but I think kids know what we're getting at and they don't want to deal with it. So, cause I've had kids have a zero on it and end up in the ER with some kind of incident within the month from their checkup. So, mm-hmm. and, But I think they also with suicide, I see – I don't see as so many of my patients, but I have seen over the years many parents that have taken that direction. And I've seen the effect on the kids in the aftermath. Those are some of the harder things to deal
with. But to treat the mental illness that leads to suicide –
right. Requires a lot of work on the doctor's part and the therapist's part, but also it ain't easy. I mean, it has to have some help on the other end. They got to do the homework that their therapists tell them to do and work at it and want to get better.
Yeah, but let's talk about the deductible. I mean, you can have
– right. But you know what? The best psychiatrists and psychologists practice outside of the health insurance system anyhow. They all take cash.
And if you don't have cash –
well, then you see the ones that the hospitals and the community centers and things like that, because they figured out if I have a service that people want, there's no reason I have to deal with the insurance company. I'm just going to charge what it costs to provide the care, and they can work. They're that good that they can work outside the system.
They can work outside the system, but I'm talking about the
patients. Not good for the patients.
You know, if you have a $5,000 deductible,
well, you hit it pretty quick with a suicide attempt and a visit to the ER. You might take care of that deductible in under an hour.
Uh-huh.
And then you get your help. See? Easy peasy.
Not so easy. Let me, before you go.
I know. I'm just, it's, you know, I'm joking, right?
Well, yeah, but it's, let me read you something from the World Health Organization, because I looked this up. And, you know, I think the issue of our time is Medicare for all.
I agree.
And income inequality in this country.
Can I just say something? If it makes anybody feel better, okay, in terms of income inequality, I am making now in a month what I used to make in one paycheck twice a month. So I am making half of what I used to make as a doctor in 2010. That's only 9 years ago. So trust me, income inequality is being fixed. It's just in the wrong direction.
The health insurance companies have been the beneficiaries of Obamacare. They've done very well. We discussed the stocks of
all of them are doing great.
Yeah. Their profits are way up, and then they cut costs. They pay their doctors half of what they used to get. Imagine what they're doing with the patients.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So the World Health Organization each year puts out a list of countries and ranks them by their suicide rate.
Okay.
And I looked it up after our friend passed away, after he killed himself. And the United States, according to the World Health Organization, is number 34.
Oh, geez, that's so low.
We have the 34th highest.
Let's make America great again.
We have the 34th highest suicide rate in the world.
Pre-Trump, post-Trump. I want to know the numbers.
This would be under Obama.
Okay, yeah, under Obama.
Yeah.
34. That sounds about right then.
34 out of 183 countries that the World Health Organization keeps track of. Let's look at the countries, and I'll do this very quickly. I'll read off a list of the countries.
Are you going to wait until the end to give me number one, right?
Well, no. I'll read the country with the highest suicide rate, and I'll go to 34. And there are a couple
of going to be long.
Yeah, but I'll do it very quickly. But when I read these countries off, ask yourself, the countries that come before America, America's 34, right?
Right.
So the countries with higher suicide rates, ask yourself, are they first world countries?
Yep.
And do they have universal health insurance in their country?
Okay.
I'll read them off very quickly. Yep. Yep. Number one is Guyana. Two is Lesotho. Three is Russia. Okay. Lithuania, Suriname, Ivory Coast. These are countries with higher suicide rates than the United States. None of this surprises us, does
right.
it? Kazakhstan, right. Equatorial Guinea, Belarus. Number 10 is an outlier, South Korea. I was surprised that South Korea has such a high suicide rate because they have a better healthcare system than we do. 11 is Uganda. Cameroon is 12. Zimbabwe is 13. 14 is Ukraine. 15 is Nigeria. 16 is Latvia. 17 is Eswatini. 18 is Togo. 19 is India. That doesn't surprise me because that's a first world and a third world country combined. Uruguay is 20th. Sierra Leone is 21st. Benin is 22nd. 23rd, outlier, Belgium. Surprised.
Huh.
Yeah. Okay.
They have universal health care, too?
Pretty sure they do.
Okay. All right.
Chad is 24th. Kiribati is 25. Cape Verde is 26. Burundi is 27. Burkina Faso is 28. Estonia is 29. Japan is 30th. Now, they have an amazing safety net. So I'm surprised that there's so much seppuku going on over there. Number 31 is Sri Lanka. A surprise coming up on 32, Finland.
Mm-hmm.
33 is Eritrea. And then 34th is United States. So we're we have the 34th highest. And then when you go
– Where's Mexico? And because they want to come here. I'm just wondering what the suicide is in Mexico, where they fell.
Yeah, great question. The number for Mexico would be – it's way down there. Way, 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 way down there. It's – the United Kingdom is 109. I'm just going – I'm looking for Mexico.
I'm just curious because we could bring our numbers down by letting more Mexican immigrants into the country.
Yeah, Italy – Italy is 142nd. Israel, 147. Mexico is 147th.
There you go. Huh? How about that? Over 100 between us and Mexico in terms of suicide. Life must be good down there.
Yeah.
Is there less suicides because there's so much drug cartel violence it cancels out the suicides? Well, that, people might have killed themselves, but the cartels got to them first.
Yeah.
That could be it.
That's an interesting
point. It's a skewed number.
Yeah, but in terms of first world countries.
Or are they coming over here to kill themselves to skew our numbers?
Dr. J. Sutay is the hardest working pediatrician in comedy. And where can they find you? Where can they watch you doing your comedy?
Going to be at Cityscape in Hartford in May. I had a great weekend working with the great Pete Corielli this past weekend, and I had a nice weekend.
Yeah, what is your website?
StandUpPediatrician.com.
Great. Can you stay on the line for 1 second, Dr. J. Sutay?
You betcha, David. Thank you.
Thank you.
He's here today. The doctor we all know is Jay. He's calling in from far away. You'll want to hear what he will say. Some good advice he will relay. Make all your troubles go away. Dr. Jay Sutay is here to stay. He tells his jokes cut. He's a comedian. He fixes children, the sick and needy ones. I'm Dr. Jay's a pediatrician.
Dr. J is in the house.
It's delightful. It's lovely. It's DeVito.
I'm being serious.
Let's go to Long Island, Queens, or Brooklyn, somewhere on that big piece of property in the East River. Joe DeVito is standing by. Where are you, Queens?
No, I'm actually in a town that's right over the border with Queens into Nassau County.
Nassau County.
Long Island.
You're in Long Island. Okay.
Yeah.
It's all one landmass, right? It's all one big island, right?
Oh, yeah. We're trapped here. We're doomed.
But I'm saying like Brooklyn, the Hamptons, Queens, it's all part of one thing.
Yeah, yeah. Montauk, Staten Island, it's all the same.
Well, Staten Island's an island.
Staten Island is its own entity.
Yes.
I feel bad for Staten Island.
I've never been there.
Oh, it's amazing. I tell people from other parts of the country will say to me, we heard you mention Staten Island. What's that like? And I tell them, imagine an island stuck between Brooklyn and New Jersey. And they just they think, oh, it's like the island of Dr. Moreau.
It's an island that's stuck between Brooklyn and New Jersey. It's the only borough that went for Trump, although now it has a Democratic congressman. Do you get a sense that you're on an island when you're in Staten Island?
It's not so much a sense as it is a haze of Axe body spray.
Well, we have a lot to talk about. As you know, we scour the news looking for the most important stories. And we're going to talk about a new study that shows men are twice as likely as women to get a spray tan before they go out on a date. Some of those numbers seem suspicious to me. We'll get that figured out in a second. We're going to meet a man who drinks a pint of his own urine every day. And then a woman who was horrified to find out that her husband is a gay porn star. An unemployed millennial has been arrested for throwing a phone at her mother. But most importantly, we're going to talk about a subject that I think is funny. But one day we'll look back and say, I cannot believe we made fun of this groundbreaking, earth-shattering new medical frontier.
Yes.
Fecal transplants.
Yes. And shockingly, it's exactly what it sounds like. You don't have to say, dumb it down, doc. Interesting thing with fecal transplants is I don't think they're looking for donors. I think they're good on the supply. They'll never be your local school won't be having a shit drive. Well, let's tell people, if they haven't figured, it actually is taking some, I believe what we used to call back in the Cheech and Chong days, some good shit. And you put up inside somebody, and if it's going from a good environment to a bad environment, it brings the good stuff with them.
Mm-hmm. So we've talked about this on the show. The minute I heard the two words fecal transplants, I think Jerry Stahl, who wrote Permanent Midnight, first told me that Adolf Hitler was the beneficiary of fecal transplants, that his doctor was injecting him with the stool of Bulgarian men. Apparently, Bulgarian men were known to have the most incredible stools. I don't know how they found that out, but apparently they drank a type of yogurt milk with a microbiome that gave Hitler the strength of an Ubermensch.
Yeah. It gave him the stool of a dozen men.
So this is not something new, and we've been talking about this. But now there's money in fecal transplants, according to the New York Times. Yeah. And Cambridge, Massachusetts, where Harvard is located, all the top doctors now are investing in what they call fecal microbiota transplants, or FMT. And it's remarkably effective, according to the New York Times.
Yeah, well, you know, I think the first thing they need to do is hire a public relations firm to change some of the terminology here. Because if you thought fecal transplant itself wasn't good enough, I don't know how well it's going to work with the good enough for Hitler. I don't know if that's going to... Wait, you think you're better than Hitler? I don't think so.
So they talk about, and I'm quoting, the curative wonders of human feces. Doctors are now stunned how healthy human excrement can be.
Yeah.
You know, you can go looking your entire life for a cure, and it turns out it's right in your toilet. I think that was the message of The Wizard of Oz.
It was. It was. If you only had a brain. That was actually the fourth character. Was they had a brain, a heart, de novo, and then a feces, high-quality feces. Yeah. That's – you got to give credit to the first person who said, what if we tried this? Whatever, can you imagine whatever the rest of the medieval barbers union was probably like? Are you out of your mind? We've got leeches to put on people, and you're telling us to put shit up their asses? Maybe we can bloodlet some sense into you.
Uh-huh. I think we can learn a lot from our dogs. Yeah. I really do, because my dog ate from the cat box.
Mm.
And
yeah, they like that. My sister used to have a problem with the dog. The dog would like wait for the cat to shit. For real. It was like a vending machine. This
is waiting for a Zagnet bar.
Yeah, that's right. This is why whenever I feel like no legal case should be made based on a drug sniffing or a bomb sniffing dog. because, look, I know that dogs can do wonderful things and they find their ways home and all that, but I've seen other things they do. And I think you can't put that animal on the stand.
It's not a reliable witness.
It's not. They're prejudiced. Think about it. Let's say you had a DNA expert coming for your trial, okay? And you found out on the whole ride there he had his head out the window. You would not trust that, okay?
My dog put his head out the window because they have a strong sense of smell.
Yeah.
And because of my son, I won't describe what he would do in the car, but my dog preferred to stick his head out the window. So fecal transplants...
Yeah.
Is there human DNA in feces?
Not really. It's more the because that would have there's a deep cut for your CSI episodes where they had to get DNA from a turd.
That was what my piano teacher used to say after every lesson. It's like trying to get DNA from a turd, Mrs. Feldman. I can't teach this boy anything. Yeah, go
ahead. It would have ruined CSI. I mean, I never would have looked at Marge Helgenberg the same. I would have thought, oh. I used to think she was attractive, but I know what she's out there running some tests on. So, yeah, I guess what it is, it's that that microbiodome. It's the probiotics and all that stuff.
That was the Pauly Shore movie, right? Microbiodome.
That was if you watch it on your phone. It was actually the smaller version of watching biodome.
They want to get microbiome. You don't need to just touch people's phones. I think there's plenty. From what I've been reading, there's no difference between what a stranger's cell phone has on it and what's inside a fecal transplant. That's what I've been reading.
I thought you were going to say if you wanted to touch some feces, you were recommending Pauly Shore. That contact with him.
Okay, so human feces, DNA. There is human DNA.
It's marginal because there is some blood in the feces if you know how to live right.
Well, you know, there used to be DNA in my feces, but that was only when my Uncle Maurice visited. Jesus, I'm sorry.
Top. No one wins with that joke. Least of all, your poor uncle. He made a man of you.
Walk it off.
That's right. We interrupt this banjo lesson. Deliverance your way. So, no, the way it works is because it's really crazy how what they're learning about the bacteria and stuff in your stomach, that the best way I had to explain to me was that you think your stomach, that your digestive tract is part of you, but it's actually this sort of thing that's this like highway that runs through you. Mm. So that we actually have more other organisms living inside of us than we have cells of our own body.
Really?
And I believe scientists call that the Richard Gere factor. That you would actually
that there are actual live animals. Living.
Yeah.
So it would be redundant to do what Richard Gere does. It's unnecessary.
It's unnecessary.
Yeah.
You just have to have some activia.
Some people think that the only reason we were put on this earth was to be the host to the billions and trillions of microbiome that's swimming inside of us.
Yeah, I mean, it makes sense. You know the, what's that thing called? That thing that looks like a jellyfish, that Portuguese man of war, that crazy looking thing. You ever see one of those? It floats around. It looks like a bag floating on the water, has all these tentacles.
Oh, Jocelyn Wildenstern.
Stop. It's actually not one creature. It's a colony of
really.
It's all and they all have their different functions, and some are responsible for paralyzing food, and some are responsible for breaking it down, and others are responsible for movement, and then I guess they have like attendance meeting once a month and then argue over parking spaces and stuff like that. But
they're all working together.
Yeah, in harmony.
Mm.
So, yeah.
I think that's Bernie's healthcare plan.
Yes. Full of shit.
No, come on. Oh, go ahead. No, we won't talk about Bernie.
I do think it's interesting how that seems to work. Like, I haven't read all of the literature on fecal transplants, but it seems like it's like people who are missing a vitamin. So that if you take a lot of vitamins and you don't need it, it just comes out of your body. But if you have a deficiency and you get that vitamin, it can change your life. So who knows? Hey, I look at it this way. How are they going to find a way to jack up the prices for this procedure?
You're talking about vitamin B and M.
Yes. Well, think about this one. I mean, a fecal transplant, it shouldn't cost anything because you don't even have to change gloves.
Dr. Alexander Korutz, a gastroenterologist at the University of Minnesota, says, this is according to the New York Times, that he fears that the FDA is favoring the interests of what he calls the poop drug cartel.
That's right.
Yeah.
Big shit. You know what? Yeah. If there is a lobbying group for
big
feces,
shit.
I think it's there. I want to hear what they have to say.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's time for them to start throwing their weight around.
Three of the companies are called Rebiotics, Ceres Therapeutics, and Vedanta Biosciences. It sounds so clean, doesn't it?
Yeah. They're really looking forward to those days when you see someone and you say, you look so healthy. You must really be full of shit. You've got that glow.
There's a fecal transplant foundation that is monitoring the activities of these companies, the Fecal Transplant Foundation.
Yeah, this is a tough sell for your biotech stocks to think you're going to put a lot of money. You know what I mean? Like CBD oil? Okay. Right?
They think now this is serious stuff here. One day we're going to look back and be ashamed that we were laughing at this.
Yeah. One day we'll look over our shoulders and laugh.
As they're taking our feces. You may have good feces. I think you do. I think you're sitting on a fortune. I bet Joe DeVito, I bet people would pay top dollar for your feces.
Oh. Yeah, I never thought about that way. My colon could be a gold mine.
They think that if we study fecal transplants, we could come up with cures for autism, ulcerative colitis, Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, and obesity, and cancer.
Sure. A lot of other conditions like thinking your shit don't stink. That's another one. not giving a shit. I do. A lot of these researchers have German last names. I'm just curious because the Germans are into that stuff, and also, you know, they might again fall back on that good enough Hitler for Hitler. So imagine if that was wow. Imagine if there was another group of Nazi scientists that. They had the ones that worked on the V2 rockets and then the ones who just did outstanding feces research.
What's the difference between a V2 rocket?
I guess it's how far up do you want to go, I guess.
So there's a stool bank in Cambridge, Massachusetts, called Open Biome. And what they do is they take what they consider to be you know, like 14 carat stools. Mm. And you and I should do a heist. I think we can make Oceans 2. We could, Oceans number 2. We could break in to that stool bank and live happily ever after.
Yeah, we'll come in and instead we'll throw it all in colostomy bags to sneak out.
Well, it'd be better than that remake of Ocean's 11. That was a piece of shit. Okay, let's move on. I think we squeezed everything we can.
Covered it. Imagine if you did that heist and you get back to the hideout and you open it up and the bag is – they're accidentally filled with money and you're like, what the hell?
From what I understand, there's a lot of fecal material on money.
Oh, yeah. One would hope.
Yeah. Apparently, fecal – people are getting really pissed off at me. All right, I'm going to change the subject. To be continued.
Yes.
Okay. I don't believe this story, but there's a nutritionist. Let's move on to something more tasteful. And I want to apologize to the listeners because it was a little self-indulgent.
Yeah.
There's a man who's a nutritionist, and he says the secret to feeling healthier every day is drinking a pint of his own urine. He's been doing it for 3 years. He says the health benefits to drinking your own urine are, you can't count the number of benefits.
Yeah. This episode is sounding like Dr. Oz went off the rails. Okay. Now, the urine drinking I'd heard about.
Really?
I've heard about people doing it. I don't know anyone who has done it. I do like how we specified drinking his own urine, because that's kind of hard to hit a friend up for that. For example. You know, I mean, that means this guy, I'm sure, has been in the position where someone said, we're drinking your own urine, not someone else's. And he's like, that's crazy. I drink someone else's urine. That's ew, gross. But I've heard that your own urine is sterile to yourself, so that it's not – it doesn't you know, when it comes out of you, it's still pretty much – well, maybe that isn't true. If you think about our digestive systems like that or removing toxins, I guess it's this theory that you get nutrients that you miss the first time around.
In ancient Rome, one of the top businesses was collecting urine because it was used to clean your clothes. And I hate to tell you this, but once I read that, whenever I got my clothes back from the dry cleaner, it smelled like urine. And This is true. You would leave your urine out. There would be a urine collector in ancient Rome. He made a lot of money gathering up all the urine. It's like a bleach. I'm not making this up.
It's ammonia. It does make me wonder, like, what stain were you trying to get out?
pee stains.
Right? You know, it's so stupid, but whenever I'm somewhere and someone spills some club soda, I say, you know, it'll get that out. And then, they, of course, no one laughs because they don't.
Oh, that? Yeah. Burn.
But I guess if – what is that for blood stains? Did you get the – I don't know, man. I mean, God. You know, the more you hear about life in ancient times, it really sounds like kind of a drag.
Fabian Farquharson, he's 37. He's from Sheffield, South Yorkshire, England. A Brit drinking his own urine. Why?
I believe they call that taking the piss out of something.
It's to get the taste of British cooking out of your mouth. He says he's been doing it for 3 years. He's also an interior designer. That's how he makes his living. He starts every day with a pint of fresh urine. And then he chases it down with 300 milligrams of aged pee. And he claims it's a thirst quencher that has left him feeling healthier, happier, smarter, and alone.
Yes, exactly. For that kissing fresh breath.
Aged pee.
I don't know. You know, a pint of fresh urine sounds like a lot.
Yeah, unless you've worked up a third.
Let me say this. A droplet of fresh urine sounds like I'm interested in.
A droplet of fresh urine sounds a lot, especially if you're Rudy Giuliani standing at the urinal waiting for the Flomax to kick in.
I mean, I think of the times where I've been peeing and wearing shorts and I feel just like anything touch my leg and I think I have to scrub myself now. I never thought I should put a cup next to that.
When they say wear a cup.
Wear a cup, yeah. They didn't say wear a decanter. what is the benefit? Like, how does it work? Does he say?
He says that he was getting a lot of pain in his stomach because he was eating at Burger King and McDonald's. They took scans and they looked. Nothing was working. And then he went home and said, I have an idea. I'm going to drink my own urine. And he said everything was healed.
Yeah, he should have tried some ideas in between. Because while I don't think you should live on Burger King and McDonald's, and I can see how that would be harmful to you, why not say, you know, I'm going to eat some carrots. Or maybe I'll have, you know, something lighter from the McDonald's menu. I'll have a McSalad. But to come home and think, you know what, this is, let's be honest, this is just a guy who wants to drink piss. not a scientist. You know what, though? I, I bet you there's guys over at the shit research council summoned this guy, like, get a load of this nut job.
He says you have to leave your fresh urine out for a month until it reaches the desired pH level of 9.
Or until your landlord tells you not again.
It tells you what?
Your landlord says you stop leaving jars of piss on the freaking windowsill.
It's called urine therapy, by the way. Are you in therapy? I'm in therapy. You're in therapy.
Is his urine therapy startup called Urine the Money?
He claims that they talk about it in the Bible.
Yeah, you know, I got to get around to reading that book again. Because people are finding a lot of, like, I don't remember that part. You know, and it's not like Star Wars where they went back and added shit later on. Like, the Bible. Maybe that's why Lot's wife was so salty. Having some sort of mineral processing issue. There's all kinds of weird shit going on in Leviticus.
Eating your own poo is in Deuteronomy.
Deuteronomy. No, but Leviticus does sound like some busybody got on a roll. Started giving out. Because if drinking pee is in the Bible, imagine the guy who was at the wedding and Jesus said, I just turned the water into wine. And he said, oh, yeah? Let's see if pull this one off.
I'm going to turn the wine into
piss. He's like, I got a couple jars of pee-pee here. Let's see. What did Jesus – Jesus said, look, I'm not a miracle worker, okay?
Okay, historical documents suggest that the Aztecs disinfected wounds with urine. And
was that during the mass beheadings?
Chinese literature talks about the healing powers of urine. Should I do this one or you? I've gotten complaints.
You know, if it's the joke about drinking a Coke.
Yes, Chinese literature talks about the health benefits of urine. So in China, Coca-Cola is considered a health drink. It's health food.
It is. Bite the wax tadpole. You familiar with that? Remember that?
What? No.
There was I think it was an urban legend that Coca-Cola in Chinese translated to bite the wax tadpole.
Oh, I didn't know that.
We'll have to run that past our Chinese consultant once they forgive us for that horrible joke.
You know, there are generations of children who don't know the pee-pee and the Coke joke.
No, they don't even know what time you go to the Chinese dentist either.
All right. They say that urine is highly sterile. That answers your question.
Yeah.
95% water, I hope.
So far, so good. What if you like it a chunky style with pulp? You get it with pulp?
With pulp!
Because you can't turn that down. Someone gives you a glass of urine with pulp and they can tell you, you know what I had to go through?
Well, if you put the pulp in, then diabetics can drink their own urine. Because, you know, diabetics have sugar in their urine, so they shouldn't be drinking their own urine. But if they have the pulp in it, they don't get that glycemic spike.
That's right. It slows it down. It's like
it
fiber.
Slows it down. Yeah. If you're a diabetic and you're listening, please make sure there's pulp in your urine before you drink it. You don't want that glycemic spike. It's God, we're going to wrap it up. 95% water, 5% nutrients such as proteins, vitamins, and minerals.
Hmm. All right. That sounds like a better nutritional profile than Gatorade. Gatorade is like artificial color and sugar substitutes and a little bit of salt.
Okay, Joe DeVito, how do people follow you on Twitter?
Oh, they can follow me at Joe DeVito Comedy and on Instagram at Joe DeVito Comedy. The website is joedevito.com. And this weekend I will be at Wisecrackers in Allentown, Pennsylvania.
Ah, wow.
They can look that up at one of the rare and elusive .biz websites. It is wisecrackers.biz.
And are you headlining?
Damn straight I am.
And you it's two nights or one night?
It's two nights. I don't schlep all the way to the Best Western or whatever the hell it is in Whitehall, Pennsylvania to open, please.
All right. This was fantastic. Stay on the line for 1 second, Joe DeVito.
Sure.
It's delightful. It's lovely. It's DeVito.
I'm being serious. Because
everybody's heard of comic Aaron Berg. Berg, Berg, Berg. Berg is the word. Well, Berg, Berg, Berg. Aaron Berg is the word. Berg, Berg, Berg. Comic Aaron Berg. Well, Berg, Berg, Berg. Aaron Berg is the word. Haven't you heard about the Berg? Everybody's talking about Aaron Berg. Well, Berg, Berg, Berg. Berg is the word. Well, ooh. Oh, where did the music go? Hello? Excuse me, I ordered music on this section. Would you? Oi, mow, mow. Oi, mow, mow, mow.
Let's go to somewhere in New York where Aaron Berg is standing by. Hello there, Mr. Berg.
How are you? I'm here at Somewhere, the new gluten-free underwear shop. Somewhere, some don't. That's our saying. Come on in. We'll give you underwear. You like them? They're gluten-free.
That's a problem. When you get a yeast infection, the underwear tends to rise.
That's why we made new gluten-free underwear. They'll keep your vagina fresh, your penis fresh, and you can call your groin them. That's right.
Okay,
no
stop,
longer
stop.
Your groin.
All what? Right. You can't do that.
You can say them because there's multiple parts down there.
All right. Don't.
The majora, the menorah.
Did you ever light the menorah?
Yes, I lit it up last night. If you know what I'm saying, consent.
How is consent? How long have you been married to consent?
Consent, she's a lovely British woman that I purchased from Nigel. And hello, I'm consent. I'm your wife. All right. Well, I guess I can do anything then because you just gave me consent. Thanks, Nigel.
But Nigel gave you consent.
That's correct.
Consent didn't give you consent.
Consent did not give me consent, but Nigel gave me consent. So you're saying I could do whatever I wanted to Nigel.
Yes, but you still have to.
I would always ask consent of consent, you know?
Uh-huh. And how is sex with consent? I understand you and consent had consensual sex last night.
Yes, consent and I had consensual sex last night. It's a little more boring than the old role play that we usually do where I pretend I'm here to fix the heater.
Mm-hmm.
And then she goes, we don't have a heater. And I go, well, then I guess we should just have sex. I'm not very imaginative when it comes to role playing because I'm off stage. So my creativity dwindles somewhat.
Mm-hmm.
So another role playing I'll do, I'll be like, I heard you got a leak. And she goes, I do. And I'm like, I don't want to have sex with you then. And then
So your marriage has survived over the years. What advice would you give to people in a relationship that's hitting a brick wall?
Hmm.
How do you spice it up?
You have to accept that your partner is probably dumber than you. once you know that, then you're mm-hmm. like, okay, it's like a make-a-wish thing. So you're like, I'm going to see this through. They're going to have a good old time.
Yeah.
My wife is, you go through tough times. That's what, you know, I consulted you many times and you would be like, look, leave this woman. You have a career.
Mm-hmm.
Get out of there. Plant cocaine in the car when she's driving. Call the police. Be like, I don't trust this woman around my baby. I think she has a lot of cocaine in the car that she rubbed my fingerprints on. And,
yeah, I think that you have to put your career first.
Yeah, you don't do that. But here's what I learned. To be a successful husband, you have to put everything else on the back. And you have to let the relationship be the most important thing. You have to open. I have new emotions now because of therapy. I used to only have anger and joy, which would be heady joy. So it wouldn't transfer itself to my body. I would only think of it mentally. But now that I've gone to therapy, I feel joy, sadness, happy, choke, yell.
Those aren't emotions. Those are physical.
That's what he said, too. Uh-huh. But I was like, then why do I do them? And he had no explanation. He's like, I used to work with Jacki Mason. And I'm like, see, it's not applicable anymore. I go, it's 2019. Emotions are different. Tit punch, is that an emotion?
No, and no, goes, you no. You can't be nice. Now,
I could say those things if I played professional sports. But okay, go ahead.
Yeah. A relationship is the most fulfilling aspect of human existence. That you can have the greatest set in the world.
Yeah.
But it doesn't match the greatest sex in the world, right? Wouldn't you much rather have great sex with your wife than play Madison Square Garden?
No. That's no. That's not even a no. A thought doesn't even enter my mind.
You would rather play
great sex with Sylvia Sage, the porno star, than play Madison Garden? Even no to that, I would say. Would I believe her if she's like, believe me, I got tested yesterday. Here's my paperwork. And it would be handwritten in crayon. And I would be like, oh, I believe you.
I'm confused. Are you saying that Madison Square Garden, sold out crowd, is better than sex with your wife?
Hmm.
If I'm a genie, I pop out of the lantern.
My wife would rather do a good open mic than have sex with me. That's what she would say. If I had to ask her, and if I was like, well, I was on Feldman's show and I said I would rather have sex with you than Madison Square Garden, she's like, I just paid $5 to entertain two people and it was better than you. She would say that. She's cruel. She doesn't get it. She's cold-blooded.
What is more important? You're not answering my question, Aaron Berg.
More important. Oh, wow.
What is more important to connect with?
In the grand scheme of things.
To connect with one human being where your heart's beat is one, or to stand in front of 17,000 people at Madison Square Garden and be worshipped for your comedy? If you have to choose between the two.
Right. Yeah, I guess I'd have to say the wife thing.
Because that's much more satisfying.
No, because that's the answer that you have to. Yeah. All right. Fine. In the long term. Yeah. And I mean, I don't care. I performed in front of 78 people this weekend and it was wonderful. So the numbers don't matter.
Right.
Which is what I tell my wife when she counts orgasms. Hey, honey. Would you rather come a little bit or come 10 times? And she goes 10 times and I go, UMSG. Whoa!
The relationship is working.
Had sex on the living room rug last night.
And was it passionate? Was it impromptu or was it scheduled? Because I know there are children involved.
I knelt before her.
You what?
Knelt. That's to kneel. Mm-hmm. The verb to kneel. Mm-hmm. Great band in the 70s, by the way.
Tony to kneel.
To kneel and what? What was the name?
The Captain and to kneel.
The Captain and to kneel. Yeah.
Muskrat. He made Muskrat Love.
Yeah, she was the captain and I was to kneel, and I kneeled in front of her. And then it was the 70s, so I was like, now you're sure we could do this while you're bleeding and we're utilizing needles? And she goes, certainly, why? And I go, well, no reason, it's the 70s. We don't know about any of this yet. And then we listen to some other music, and I go, I bet you this Freddie Mercury guy gets his share of the ladies.
Okay, all right. Yeah.
It's all innuendo.
70s so, sex. So I, what
I'm
did you...
I'm going to walk you through it.
Since it was the 70s, what was the difference between the carpet and your wife?
Shag. Yeah. You get it, because hairy. So I knelt before her, and she had her... she's on the lovely bobopedic sofa that we had. Mm-hmm. And her feet are up, and then I started to work on her toes. Some people do that.
Mm-hmm.
So I brought in these two Asian women that spoke no English, and they go, pedicure? And mm-hmm. I go, yeah. And they yell, pick a color. So they did her nails.
Were they wearing a mask?
Yeah, they have surgical masks on all the time. They also like picking their nose on the subway.
I love surgical masks. I don't know what it is. If I'm with a woman who's wearing a surgical mask, I feel like I'm a little boy at Neverland.
Yeah. And then does security come in and go, he's not a doctor, and remove you? Heard Michael Jackson got in some R. Kelly type trouble. Let me continue with the
intercourse here. Yes.
So I suck on her toes a little bit, and she goes, what are you doing? Sucking on my dirty feet. And I go, oh, I didn't know that they were dirty. So then I went and gargled with mouthwash, came back. You don't know sometimes. And then we went down on the floor, and what's the term? I pleasured her. I gave her pleasure.
Oh, so you left. Where'd you go?
Yes. I went to the Stop and Shop, picked up the milk we needed, got some emery boards for her to file her nails down, and let her watch a dancing show hosted by Jennifer Lawrence. I think it was Jennifer Lopez, but I couldn't pronounce it.
Yeah.
and then we did intercourse.
You did intercourse. And for how long? For how long?
I'm going to give it maybe 15 minutes.
That's it?
That's a lot, David. When you're married, as you've been 18 times on paper, in order to get your Russian dolls into the country. 15 minutes is good when you're married. And that's me. You know, I could be over in 30 seconds if I wanted to. I could just plug away and be like, there you go. You get nothing. Back up to the attic with ye.
That's the role playing that you do where you pretend to own an apartment building in Amsterdam during World War II, right?
Yeah. And I go, shh, what's that noise? And she goes, I don't know. It sounds like tourists that bought tickets to come in.
So your fantasy is that you're hiding in an attic in Amsterdam.
Mm-hmm.
Like you snuck upstairs into the attic so that the tourists couldn't hear you have sex.
Yeah. Right before my wife hits climax all the time, I throw my voice and I yell, Yehudin! And then she thinks it's coming from outside, and you hear a lot of boots walking. They wore heavy boots back then, so you're... And then they drink milk. A lot of the time they sit down and drink milk because that was a sign of white power.
I see. So the sex was good 15 minutes. I mean, have you ever tried doing it for an hour?
Yeah, back when I was young.
Do you ever look at a clock while you're having sex?
I used to. Not anymore. Now, once in a while, I'll look at the clock when I'm done and I'm cleaning myself up. And then I'll be like, oh, that was pretty good. Now I still got an hour to do what I want to do. That's what I think.
Right. Yeah. Do you ever view it like, how long can we go here?
Yeah, once we did that in Delaware at a hotel. And that was like an hour and a half, 2 hours.
Mm-hmm.
Not as enjoyable.
And women, let me ask you a question about women. Mm-hmm. Women would, left to their own devices, and by devices, their vibrator, they would just want to have sex all day.
Really?
I think.
Why don't they do that? You know what would be awesome? If there was a thing where women could just be with other women, if that was legal.
Yeah. But don't you think that women don't, they could just keep going?
Yeah. My wife can. She can do like 3 or 4 sometimes. But it also, she gets bad headaches after she cooms, as we call it.
Well, you've got to watch your elbows.
Yeah, it's the elbows are flailing a lot. But she does, she gets like freeze brain, like she sucked a Slurpee too quick. And she'll go to the bathroom.
Wait a second, is your wife dyslexic? She gets a headache after sex?
Yes, this is correct.
She's supposed to get it before sex. So,
no. And then she goes, I made all the sandwiches for the kids in the Ziploc bags. I need to sleep. But yeah, after sex, she'll go and drip out for like an hour, hour and a half.
You have like a little pan that you put underneath there, right?
Yeah, like we from put Jiffy her up Lube. On one of those things where you change the oil in the car.
How many orgasms do you have to go before you have to change the fluids in her?
Well, she had 2 last night. One was mouth, the other one was weenus, as I call it. And I go, you like that weenus? And she goes, you are not sexy at all. And I go, that's not what the guys in the steam bath say.
Can you have sex in areas where your child might be? In other words, not that the child's going to walk in, but do you feel like there's a separate part of the home for sex and the child should not ever be in that room?
Clearly not, because we did it in the living room last night.
Okay.
Usually we'll do it in our bed, but sometimes the baby comes into the bed the next day. You can't, you know, the only thing that you can hope for is that you clean up the Dexter-esque scene as soon as you're done.
The Dexter-esque scene.
Dexter-esque scene.
The saran wrap.
Yeah, the saran wrap and the sheets that look like they were used to carry away Somalian pirates.
So the sex is good. So I understand.
I have sex. Yeah, we don't have sex a lot.
Do you ever strip?
Once I have it once, I'd like to do it more.
Uh-huh.
But I also like, see, I come from a time when I was very sexy, where I was a stripper, so I would just take my clothes off and play with my own wang. And women would want to do sex. Now, my wife does not find that appealing. She wants me to touch her and caress her. She's so gay. I don't understand it.
Being romantic. Do you think when a man is romantic, he's revealing his feminine side to a woman?
I think it's a vulnerability that women like. I don't know if it's a feminine side necessarily, but there's a vulnerability there. I've been with some women that are more attractive to machismo, whereas my wife wants intimacy and touching, kissing, and you can't just be like, take your pants off, I'm going to put it in. You can't say that.
Machismo is that stuff she cleans up after sex, right?
No, that's gizmo.
Oh, I thought that's
machismo.
Gizmo is where they put the terrace in Cuba. Don't we have a place in Cuba?
Yes, Machismo Bay. That's where they put them. They take the man, they make them wear jean shorts and gold chains outside of their V-neck T-shirts. Machismo Bay. They spray them down in Dracar Noir.
Dracon Noir. I love that cologne. Yeah.
They give them Honda Accords that are dropped down a little bit with rims. Machismo. They take them to nightclubs in Queens where they make them dance to Baby Don't Hurt Me and other songs from the 90s.
And then they waterboard them.
Yeah. And I put my thumb in her butt last night.
Oh, that's sweet.
Thank you.
Were you practicing bowling?
I put it in and I go, Steve, right? And she goes, wrong sport. And I go, well, let me put another one in then. I call this the two-finger fastball. Uh-oh, watch out. Here's a knuckleballer. You want to feel the slider or the sinker next? Oh, boy, I'm tired. Let's bring in the relief guy.
Do you remember every anniversary that she creates to test you?
No. And sometimes I just won't. She'll go, today's the anniversary of blah, blah, blah. I go, I know that. And we don't give gifts anymore. We just give cards.
You don't go shopping because it's the 10th anniversary since, you know, she passed Wynn in front of you and you said it was okay.
Nope, don't do any of those things.
Right.
Just cards now. That's it. No more. We're not giving in to the capitalist system, man.
And how are things going to change with Bernie as our next president? I always clear my throat with Bernie because he's very Flemish.
First of all, I'm going to say this. I love the chicken that his company makes. It's wonderful.
Mm-hmm. Rabbi Sanders.
Yes, and I don't know. I heard he gave a good speech. His wife opened for him in Brooklyn the other day, which that's always nice. I bring my wife to open for me sometimes, and then she bombs, and then I can't make fun of her. it's the worst thing. You can't even fuck around with her in the green room. You'll say something, she'll be like, "What did you say?" This is not how. comics kibitz. We're trying to kibitz back here. We're schmeckling. And then she'd say, what did you say? And then sometimes she'll do really well. And then other times she'll just eat a dick up there and then come off and I got to lie and be like, hey, that was great. She's like, don't fucking placate me. And I'm like, all right.
What does a female comic want? You're married to one. What does she want? When she goes on the road, is she trying to get laid?
I don't think so. No. She wants, they want success mostly.
I spoke
with Lori Kilmartin today, who's the head writer of Conan, and she got into a Twitter battle with Stormy Daniels because Stormy Daniels is doing stand-up now.
So?
Well, Lori's stance is that of an old school comedian, and she believes that the people that have earned those spots at clubs should get them instead of people that are just famous doing stand-up now.
Well, suppose, yeah. Well, maybe somebody, they should swap out.
If That's Stormy's, how Stormy got into this problem.
Yeah, I mean, if Stormy's gonna do stand-up, I think...
Other people should be able to do porn.
I think we have, yeah, there's only, it's a zero-sum game.
Okay, it makes sense. Here's my thoughts on it.
I'm surprised Lori would get into a Twitter battle with Stormy.
Lori loves getting into Twitter battles. I think, look, if people want to pay to see Stormy, they can pay to see Stormy. It's a capitalist market. The market demands it, then you can do it. That's the beauty of America. But I also think the notion of a meritocracy is somewhat dated. I don't think that really happens in stand-up anymore. The cream doesn't necessarily rise to the top, and it's not always best guy for the job. So she wants to do it, she can do it, and you kind of got to make your own way. I like watching her get in trouble.
It's people fun to watch people like comedy. Famous people.
Yeah.
That erases a lot of sins. If you're famous... You don't have to be funny.
No.
You have to be funny.
Yeah, I have to be funny.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you just know it. And even if I get famous, I'd still want to be funny. I wouldn't want to just be famous.
Mm-hmm.
It's not fun. What's the point of that?
Would you open for Stormy?
No. I would say no. Would you?
Yeah, I would.
You would?
Yeah.
So you'd just kneel down and go, all right, strap it on. And you'd open.
Yeah. Yeah, I would do that.
You would. If she was like, hey, David, I'm coming to Union Hall. Do you want to do 15 minutes in front of me?
I would love to see Stormy Daniels playing Brooklyn.
Yeah.
Because everybody hates Trump. And they probably think, like my mother does, that Stormy Daniels is a hero. Because they've never actually watched what she does for a living. If I had to force my mother and her friends who think Stormy Daniels is so brave and such a feminist, if I had to force them to look at what Stormy Daniels does for a living, I think...
Oh, David, look at what they're doing to her against her will. David, all six of them are just standing there, forcing her to kneel in front of... Oh, David, look at what... Where are the handguns that they must be holding to her head to do this? Oh, Storm, you weather it. You're a hero. It's you, Erica Jong, and then that lady that married her brother.
Andrew Dworkin.
Yeah. It's lovely. I'd love to watch her do it, and I'm sure she... Would you date her? If she was like, hey, David, I know we're both kind of into comedy. Would you feel comfortable dating her?
I don't think she would find me interesting.
Everybody finds you interesting. You're very compelling, charismatic, approachable, funny.
Mm-hmm.
What if she saw you on stage and she's like, ooh, I like this edgelord?
I would say to her, just keep the image that you saw on stage in mind as you're talking to me.
Yeah.
Throughout this relationship, just remember what you saw on stage, not what's happening in front of you.
Right. Oh, I spilt my soup all over your lap, Miss Daniels. I'm sorry. We should have never come to the Ritz Diner on 62nd. Everybody knows me here now, and they think I paid you for your services. They don't know that this is a bilateral conversation. Oh, boy, oh, boy. Okay, could we have the turkey bacon, but could you make it the kosher beef one? Thank you. Stormy, you gotta try the pie. Have you eaten pie here? I did. Oh, boy, I'm schwitzing over here. I'm so super nervous. I can't believe you came across the Williamsburg Bridge just to have a late lunch with me, Mrs. Daniels. Or is it Ms.? All right, well, a little bit about me. My name is David Baruchatan, and I'm a Feldman. I'm currently 58, wink, wink, years old. My hobbies include my children, watching golf on Sundays, and also fixing my Sensodyne collection. I have a very large Sensodyne collection because my left ones are a little very tingly. Whether hot or cold, they'll sing and it feels like I'm chewing on rocks or stones. God, I wanted to buy a goldfish, but I have problems with death because I watched too much Richard Belzer as a child. Now, if you look over there, you can see the East River. I'd love to walk you down there. You know, they filmed a Woody Allen movie there once. I think it was called I Married My Asian Child. I'm edgy. So let me ask you this. Since you work in the industry, do I need to A, wear prophylactic, B, be erect, or could I just mush it around? C, could I take pictures of you and then post them on this thing that I found called MySpace? It's like MySpace, but I don't pronounce the Y, because why would I? Oh, I'm going to write that one down. I'm going to send that to the Conan people. It's David Feldman dating. Hey, Stormy, if this doesn't go well, I got two more lined up, so you better jump in. You like music? Me too. My alarm clock plays a beep beep noise.
Aaron Berg, what is the name of your podcast?
In Hot Water, Compound Media, Monday to Thursday, 9 a.m.
Oh, hang on for 1 second. And how do people follow you on Twitter?
At Aaron Berg Comedy.
Uh-huh. What is the name of your book? You wrote a book.
I have two books. One is called Mr. Manners, Proper Etiquette for the Modern Degenerate.
Yeah.
The other one is called American Etiquette, Failing Upwardly in a Fox News Nation. The third book I'm writing on is David Feldman's Bumble Profile. Dear ladies, I know you're supposed to come to me, but I'm sitting on the edge of my seat. Hurry, 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 reach out. Hurry, reach out. Oh, no, my wife just got home. I was supposed to be taking a nap. Oh, God, Lord Christ in heaven. Now I've got to deal with that all day. Oh, my. Hang on. Let me make sure the baby's not sleeping. Oh, God. Is the baby sleeping, honey? Oh, the baby's sleeping. All right. Oh, my wife is up. Hi, I'm David. I hope you like hot coffee because I have a Groupon to get two of them. I'm going to take you to this place. It's called Argo Tea. They usually don't serve coffee, but they've just put some on their menu. And that's why it's 2-for-1 because they don't really trust it. It's made from a tea bag. They call it tea coffee. I think it's really just tea that they let soak a long time. I don't think it's very good at all, but I think this will be a nice way to chat. My mother always loved me. No Freudian tendencies whatsoever. My father and my Zadie were both Holocaust survivors at the same time, which makes no sense to me, but I think one of them invented the time machine. I was going to go into selling diamonds, but I didn't like making that commute every day to Midtown. It seemed like such a schlep to me. My parents wanted me to go to law school, but I was like, I'll sue you if you send me. And they go, oh boy, that's irony.
Stay
dating
on the...
David Feldman. Dating David Feldman.
Perfection. Stay on the line for 1 second. Absolute perfection.
Everybody's heard of comic Aaron Berg. Berg, Berg, Berg. Berg is the word. Well, Berg, Berg, Berg. Aaron Berg is the word. Berg, Berg, Berg. Comic Aaron Berg. Well, Berg, Berg, Berg. Aaron Berg is the word. Haven't you heard about the Berg? Everybody's talking about Aaron Berg. Well, Berg, Berg, Berg. Where did the music go? Hello? Excuse me, I ordered music on this section. Would you... Oi, mow, mow. Oi, mow, mow, mow. Oi, mow, mow. Oi, mow, mow, mow. Oi, mow, mow. Oi, mow, mow, mow. Oi, mow, mow. Oi, mow, mow, mow.
Let's go to
California, where Emil Guillermo is standing by. You can read him over at the Asian American Legal Defense and Education Fund. He's also the host of the PETA podcast, People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals. We're going to talk about horse racing, the Iditarod, Brody Stevens, Jesse Smollett, Bao winning an Oscar, and Donald Trump in Hanoi and Michael Cohen's testimony. Let's start off with the PETA podcast. You say 20 horses were put down, David, in Santa Anita? Where is Santa Anita?
Santa Anita is in Arcadia, which is near Pasadena. And it's a great looking racetrack. It's one of the glorious racing sites, but it's also become a kind of monument of death the last few weeks. 20 horses have died there racing, and some racing and some in training. So PETA has called for an investigation into the veterinarians and the trainers to figure out why isn't something being done about the horses, who they found out that horses who break down, they usually have had some kind of pre-existing injury that have been masked by drugs and that they've been cleared to race when they shouldn't have. So PETA's calling for this investigation on veterinarians and trainers there at Santa Anita.
I can't imagine horses getting better attention than our gymnastics teams. I mean, what they're doing to humans.
Well, look, here's the thing that's really ironic, right? Football season just ended. If there was a report of 20 athletes in the NFL dying from something, well, wait a minute. There are athletes dying of mental problems due to the kind of impacts they've had because of concussions and whatnot. Well, you know, this is the thing. We take for granted the health of these of human beings, the health of these animals. We don't look into it. And, you know, PETA's motto is animals aren't there for, you know, to be used for our entertainment. They're there to be used for, you know, for things like the circus. And I think ultimately that's what's going to happen to racing. It's going to die a natural death and no one's going to care.
It's going to die a natural death. So tell me about horse racing. Where is PETA's position on horse racing?
Well, like I said, animals should not be used for our entertainment. That means horse racing. But remember, horses, they're a kind of a symbolic thing in animal rights history, right? The SPCA was started because of the protests against carriage horses. And so
they still can't get rid of the carriage horses here in Central Park.
They still can't get rid of them, and it's so frustrating because, you know, there was pushback, there was politics. It looked like, you know, the administration there, the mayoral administration, was going to, you know, take care of it, but they got pushback. So it's an ongoing fight, and every time I see a carriage horse, you know, I was watching. You know, Pete Holmes is crashing last night, and they were in Charleston, and what do you know? There's a scene with a carriage horse.
Well, it's interesting that you bring up Charleston because, to me, it's New York City's version of the Robert E. Lee statue. People say, when they talk about the carriage horses, it's part of our history.
Yeah, a part of the history should be forgotten or should be changed and should be just, you know, put away. I mean, there's no reason for those carriage horses to exist except that people want this kind of a sentimental ride down memory lane, or they want to revisit these old memories of, well, forget about the memories in history. Let's think about what it does to the horses, the enslavement of the horses being run into the ground. You know, the cruelty in terms of the treatment of the horses. We don't need that.
Right.
I mean, that's
New York liberals.
Yes.
New York liberals. You got to take the Robert E. Lee and the Stonewall Jackson statues down in Charlottesville. But come on, these horses through Central Park, it's part of the charm. And by the way, New York City almost sided with the Confederacy during the Civil War. Well, I can't think of anything more romantic than sitting in a carriage and staring at a horse's ass as it spews wet flatulence my way.
Yeah. God, they get the greenhouse gas argument in there too. You know, it's Yeah.
To have my arm around a beautiful woman and to smell horse apples. What could be more romantic? God, so it's horse racing in general, right? That PETA wants to get rid of horse racing in general.
Well, the position is, yes, horse racing in general. But, you know, the industry's a strong one. The industry, they get network time. They get big sponsors. People are always excited about the Kentucky Derby and the Triple Crown, even though, you know, there's a lot of people betting on horses, but the demographic of horse racing isn't getting any younger, and the audience for horse racing is dying. So, you know, to hasten this, there are ways in which the industry can, if they're going to continue, there are ways to make it better on the horses. But these incidents in Santa Anita, 20 horses dying. I mean, that's really something. And the thing is, they know why this is happening. As I said, the horse racing board knows that horses that break down, they break down because there were pre-existing conditions or pre-existing.
And these are investments.
Well, they are investments. And what allows the investment they are? You know, you pay a trainer, and this is why PETA is calling for an investigation on the trainers and the veterinarians. Because immediately when you talk about horses dying on the tracks, people say, oh, well, you know, let's shut down the track and let's there's something at the surface, something's wrong with the racing surface, and it's the rain that's causing this. When in fact, they're are clear motivations on the part of trainers to keep horses running in the rain, to keep horses in training, and there's motivations on the part of the owners to keep their horses running no matter what. Because if you're paying as an owner a couple thousand a month to keep a horse fed and in training, well, you want to see that horse racing so that you can win purses. And that's because that's how you make your profit, right? And you run these horses in the most expensive race to make the most money. But unfortunately, the horses are kind of divided up into classes. And so they're the elite racers that go into the Kentucky Derby and whatnot. But the majority of horse racers or horses who are racing are in the so-called claiming races. They're in these lower level races. Mm. And that's where a lot of this larceny takes place, where horses who shouldn't be running, they should be resting, they should be recuperating. They're given drugs to mask what is really going on with them. And they're being sent out to the track because owners are paying thousands of dollars in vet and training fees, and they need to win purses to keep the profits going, or if there is profits. A lot of these horse racers or horse racing stables are just, you know, mom and pops.
Okay.
They're looking for a dream. Anyway, investigation is needed.
Okay. The Iditarod, I believe it's the 47th annual Iditarod. It started on Saturday in Anchorage, Alaska. When did the Iditarod? I always thought the Iditarod has been around for a century. It's only 47 years old.
Well, 47 years old in its current form, right? But it's been around for a long time because
In dog years.
the historical basis of the Iditarod was it was a humanitarian concern, right? Get the serum to the people. Mm-hmm. We gotta
Balto.
Get medicine.
Remember
people.
Balto?
To what?
Balto.
There's a
statue. Yeah, Balto is in Central Park. It's a dog who delivered the medicine.
Oh, well, you got me there, David. My Balto history is a little deficient. I'm sorry. But that's good. I mean, that was it, right? Get the medicine to the people. And also, it was a relay race. So it wasn't an endurance race like, oh, well, we've got to, you know, like kill these dogs and grind them down to nothing. But 47 years ago, they changed it. So instead of a race for serum, instead of a race to get medicine to the people in the, you know, the out country, it became, and instead of a relay race, it became an endurance race. And so 52 teams of dogs this year are competing for $500,000 in prize money.
Huskies.
Huskies. Well, you know, some people say, oh, well, they're bred. They're bred for this. No, they're not. They're bred to be regular dogs like the dogs that you have in your home. And that's the real sad thing about the Iditarod, because the romance of what it used to be, they're trying to carry it on now in this new endurance form, and they're killing dogs. 150 deaths. That's what's been reported in the history of the race. One last year, and five dogs connected to the race last year died, but that's doesn't count the deaths that are unreported because of training and because of, you know, dogs who may be, you know, there's reason to believe that that number is lower than it should than reality.
So how does this work? A guy stands on a sled. And he's got how many dogs in front of him?
I don't know exactly how many are in his team, but there are 50 teams. I think they're like 15 dogs.
15 dogs, and does, he doesn't have.
You got to finish with five. You know, you got to, and now there's a new rule this year. When a dog dies, the musher, they're called mushers. You're out. You're disqualified.
Who's a musher?
A musher is a guy who, this is what he does for his life.
You know why he's called a musher?
Why, David?
Because Viagra doesn't work for him. He's kind of mushy, and he goes, you know what? I can't please a woman. I'll just participate in the Iditarod because I'm a musher. So he goes, mush, mush, and the dogs, do they hate it?
The dogs are loving it. You know, in fact, there are books out by leading mushers who talk about starving dogs so that the dogs will want and be motivated to keep running to their destination faster. And ironically, you know how dogs die in the Iditarod? You know how the primary reason of death in the Iditarod?
Oh.
Vomit, choking. The dogs choke on their own vomit. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's hard to understand, but when you see the stress that these dogs are under, this is the number one cause of death of these dogs. And this is sport. This is considered sport for the mushers, for the glorification of the mushers, not the dog. You mentioned Balto, right?
Mm-hmm.
God, I wish I knew about Balto. I didn't.
He's 100 years old this year.
But see, most people don't. They don't go crazy about the dog. They remember the mushers. It's for the humans. It's not for the dogs. Don't care. If you gave the dogs a choice to run, they wouldn't run a 1,000-mile race because they don't get the money. And most of these dogs, as I said, 150 have died in this race, this 47-year-old race. The time has come, and a lot of sponsors are pulling out, like Coke. Coke has pulled out, Coca-Cola. Other Jack Daniels has pulled out. There's still $500,000 in prize money in this race, and the winner gets $50,000.
It's interesting that Jack Daniels pulled out because they used to sponsor Whiskey Dick, who was one of the top mushers. He used to win the Iditarod all the time, and he had an endorsement deal with Jack Daniels, so I'm surprised.
Whiskey Dick. Whiskey Dick the musher.
Whiskey Dick the musher. Yeah. All right. So what do we do? We boycott the Iditarod?
You got to call, go to PETA.org, tell the people who, because the lifeblood of the Iditarod, not the dogs, not the mushers, it's the corporate sponsorship. If the corporate sponsorship dries up, we'd see an even smaller Iditarod, if not the end of the Iditarod. And as I said, just like in horse racing, just like the circus. I mean, is anyone mourning the death of Ringling Brothers except for a few clowns?
The Ringlings,
I'm sure. But, yeah. You know, as far as animal circuses go, people have learned to live without animal circuses, and they've realized that it was a bad idea from the start.
Okay.
And this is what's going to happen with each and every one of these endeavors. Horse racing, the Iditarod, they have to come to an end.
Yeah. You wanted to talk about a friend of mine, Brody Stevens.
I did. You know, I didn't know him, but I have just been stunned by the outpouring of emotion and, you know, reaction to his suicide. you know, as a performer myself, I was affected by it because I discovered Brody late. I mean, I knew he was in The Hangover, but I discovered him late, and I enjoyed his command of the stage and his, because he really did. He had a unique style. Mm-hmm. And I loved his command. And when I heard that he had done, and I was watching old videos of him, you know, before his suicide. And then when I heard about it, my heart sank, because look, we're not immune to mental health issues. We're not immune. I'm talking about the general population, but Asian Americans, I write for a lot of Asian American publications, we're very sensitive to the stigma that's attached to suicide and mental health issues. And we don't talk about it because of that. And, you know, even my own family, we've felt these mental health issues and suicide. These are real, real issues. And so, you know, my heart goes out to his friends and to his family. And I'm saddened. I'm saddened by it. You know, I watch his videos before his death, he had such a unique style. And, you know, in the kind of things that I do when I talk to audiences, I learned a lot from Brody Stevens. And I just, like I said, I can't fathom the idea that, you know, he's gone now, because we're left with, his work, which is now on video and you can see it on YouTube. But I just don't get it, you know, because I was watching an old one of the last Periscope things he made just before his death, and it didn't sound like anything was wrong. How do we know? We don't know. And unless you're an old friend, I don't know. This speaks to the whole mental health idea. How, you know, if you need help, seek help. There's no stigma. You know, Brody Stevens was, you know, he was. You could look at his life and see him as a success, although, you know, we know it's tough in the business. And yet, were people there? Who was there to help? We don't, you know, unless people say break free of the stigma, mm-hmm. they got to get the help and they got to reach out.
Yeah, and let me speak to that. Reach out and help. Call that 800 number. With all due respect, that's horseshit, because unless we elect Bernie Sanders or a Democrat who's going to give us Medicare for all, we're not going to solve the suicide problem in this country.
No, I agree with you.
There are two things at play here. One is mental health is expensive.
Right.
People need to go see a shrink. They don't have the money to go see a shrink. People need drugs. Drugs are too expensive.
Right.
So until we address Medicare for all and wealth inequality in America, I don't want to hear anybody say to me, if you know anybody who you think might be in danger of suicide, call this 800 number. That is just a symptom of a very sick country care.
I agree with you. Look, and you lived in California. I still do. And I was giving a little talk yesterday. It was open to the public. Some guy comes in, homeless, clearly in need of mental health care, clearly in need of meds. Did he get it? No, but I allowed him to talk when he had a question, when I was talking about Filipino immigration and the history of Filipino Americans, because I recognized that he was a guy in need. So I know that just saying call an 800 number isn't going to solve anything unless we have the leadership and we have the policy changes.
What about the free market? Why don't we? Certainly the free market could solve this, and lowering taxes, I think, would solve this.
Well, look, the free market, you mean like privatized
services? I'm joking. I'm being sarcastic. I just
think that I'm with you. I'm with you. We need to address it so that the 800 calling, so that saying call an 800 number isn't BS.
Okay. I want everybody to listen to this very carefully. This is my comment on Brody Stevens, and I miss him, and it's very sad. The World Health Organization rates countries by the incidence of suicide. They come out with each year a list of the top 140 countries and their suicide rates. So America is number 34, the 34th highest suicide rate in the world. And I'm going to read you who's ahead of us. Okay? And let's try to figure out, of the 33 countries that have a higher suicide rate than America, let's first ask ourselves, when I name these countries, are they first world countries, and do they have universal health insurance? Okay?
Okay.
Number one is Guyana.
Guyana?
Yep.
Is number one.
Yeah. Number two, Lesotho. Number three is Russia. No surprise there. Number four is Lithuania. Number five is Suriname. Number six is the Ivory Coast. Number seven is Kazakhstan. Number eight is Equatorial Guinea. These are countries that have higher suicide rates than America. Number nine is Belarus. This is interesting. One outlier here is number 10, South Korea. A higher
South Korea. So the Asians will kill themselves at a higher rate than the U.S.
And they have a health care system that we would be envious of. Number 11 is Uganda. Number 12 is Cameroon. 13 is Zimbabwe. 14 is Ukraine. 15 is Nigeria. 16 is Latvia. 17 is Eswatina. 18 is Togo. 19 is India.
Another Asian country.
19 is Uruguay. 21 is Sierra Leone. 22 is Benin. 22 is Belgium. So far, the only outliers are Belgium and South Korea.
India, too.
India too, but they're a third world country.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
24 is Chad. 25 is Kiribati. 26 is Cape Verde. 27 is Burundi. 28 is Burkina Faso. 29 is Estonia. 30 is an outlier, Japan.
Ooh, Japan.
More 31 Japan. Is Sri Lanka. Another outlier, Finland.
Finland.
32.
It's cold. The cold weather.
Yes. 32.
The hockey team lost.
32. It's tied with Eritrea. And then 34 is the United States. And then the countries that have lower suicide rates, you can go check it out. You know, France, Sweden, Australia, New Zealand, Great Britain, Switzerland, Ireland, the Czech Republic, Canada, way down there, Luxembourg, Norway, Cuba, Chile, the Netherlands, Denmark, Germany. Germany's way down there. So what do they all have in common? United Kingdom is 109th. They have universal health insurance. So that's the issue. Spain is way down there. Brazil is way down there. Italy is way down there. Israel is 147th. Mexico is 147th.
Wow. Mexico is 147th. Those are the people who didn't go across to the United States because they stayed for the health care.
Yeah.
You know, it's funny because all the top 33, you know, then you get to the United States, most of them, the majority sounded like former Soviet satellite, Russia, right? Russia was like three, right? Number three. And then the African countries, right?
Yeah. So we have Japan and South Korea and I believe Finland.
And, you know, the only thing I would say about Japan and South Korea would be that maybe there you have the stigma factor, you know, plays a role and people don't seek out help. Maybe. I'm just speculating there.
So that's my comment about Brody Stevens.
Yeah.
It's not good enough to say to people, if you know somebody who's depressed, call an 800 number and don't commit suicide and seek help. Telling people to seek help in a country where you can't seek help is sophistry. Jesse Smollett.
Hey, can I say one thing, David, about one more thing about Brody Stevens?
Yeah.
I mourn him because I loved his style and I'm sorry to see what happened. But maybe also there's this idea that what is it about seeking an audience? What is it about doing the thing that we do in the public that you know, there's that need to, maybe he wasn't getting, you know, now I don't want to speak out of school, but there is, when you get in front of an audience and try to make them laugh or try to please them, there's a need that gets fulfilled when you're, yeah, when you're up there. I think about that, and I think about,
what was the statuses of his health insurance? That was the first thing that occurred to me.
Yeah. Yeah.
I wanted to know what Brody's health insurance situation was.
Yeah. That's true too. I mean, cause that does come into play when you say, can you get the meds? Can you get the help? You know, and like I said, I'm dealing with my family too, and it's, you know, health insurance, you know, thank goodness.
How many times did he call for help and they said to him, you better go to an emergency room. I can't help you. You're behind on the bill. Or I can't give you any more medicine. You're behind. You haven't paid for it. Yeah. I want to know the financial status of his health insurance. If you're going to do an autopsy on somebody who commits suicide, why they died and how they died, I'd like to know the status of their health insurance.
Right. Or what? There had to be some kind of trigger, or maybe he was off his meds, or maybe he was on. I mean,
their meds because they can't afford them. Jesse Smollett.
You know, that was, he's sort of been pushed off the news because, you know, he's been arrested. He was released on bail. He continues to maintain his innocence. But I think this was a lesson for media types. It's also a lesson of how news works now in our country. The power of social media, the power to just sort of take over a story. And I mean, because I was ignoring this story for, not ignoring it, but I was saying, okay, look, I don't know everything about Jesse Smollett, so I'm going to wait to see. Maybe it's truthful. Maybe it's not. He goes on Good Morning America and, you know, he makes his claim. He was beaten up and, you know, he's this gay guy and, you know, he wanted to show young gay boys that he wasn't, that he fought back. And then the story sort of crumbled, you know, the guys came out and they were interviewed by the Chicago police, and it was determined, or they were cooperating to expose the fact that they were paid by Smollett. Right. So we don't know
who are the Seaport Three.
Well, all right. So here's what I wrote on the Aldef blog. I just said, look, we're going to have this period of time now where people are going to be very skeptical because of Jesse Smollett, you know, about whether or not something is a hate crime. And all I did in my article, which I wrote a couple of weeks ago, was I pointed out, you live in New York. Do you know about the Seaport Three? Do you know what happened at Sheepshead Bay back there in January 15th?
Not until I read about it over at Aldef.
Yeah, there were three Asian American workers, Fufai Pun, Kung Nin Tang, and Tismet Pun, who were all working there, and they were managers and cooks and various jobs there at the Seaport Buffet in Sheepshead Bay. And they were attacked by Arthur Martunovich, a 34-year-old immigrant from Estonia who had a history of mental health problems. They were attacked, and not just attacked, they were hammered to death. Martunovich saw a movie, thought Asians were bad guys, treated their women, you know, poorly, and he hammered these three innocent Asians. Now, they were in the tabs, but you live in New York and you're a big reader of, you know, the media. You didn't hear about it. You didn't know about it. And my question was, why is it that people don't know about this sensationalistic crime in right there in the media capital of the world? These three Asian guys, because if you're an Asian immigrant, no matter how sensationalistic this mini massacre was, you're not going to hear about it.
Right.
You're not going to know it. And so here was all this hubbub about Jesse Smollett. Oh, you know, he did this and, you know, he's got this noose around his neck, and everyone was sort of jerked by this story. And when the truth came out, it was like, the letdown was real because, hey, we bought it. We bought that story.
Which means if he wasn't really a victim of a hate crime, then hate crimes don't exist.
Well, it's like, my point was, when, you know, why didn't these Asians get the at least the same kind of treatment that Jussie Smollett got initially?
So what is the status with the Seaport 3?
Well, the hate crime charges eventually were brought. I mean, it took a couple weeks. But, you know, it was at least the crime happened January 15th. And it wasn't until toward the end of the month that that hate crime charges were the charges were elevated to hate crime status by the DA. So we're in that process now. And, you know, here's the thing about we were talking about mental health. 34-year-old Arthur Martunovich, this immigrant from Estonia. You know, did we hear anything about, get rid of these immigrants from Estonia? Get rid of these, you know. We didn't hear anything about this case.
Right.
And also, here's the other thing. Arthur Martunovich with these mental health problems. Did we hear anything about, we ought to do something about these people of these mental health problems? Why didn't this immigrant from Estonia have the kind of care he needed? So he didn't. You know, so he wouldn't watch a movie, see Asians treating women wrong in the movie in this fictional sense, and then feel so moved that he takes a hammer and goes out to the buffet in Sheepshead Bay and murders three people, allegedly. Yeah. Let's say allegedly. I don't want to. I mean, they got the case. The case is, you know, in process.
Okay. Before you go, talk to me about Trump visiting Hanoi and meeting with Kim Jong-un.
Oh, well, you know, I just, you know, David, did you really think that there was a shot that there would be anything worthwhile to come out of this? I mean, I think Trump really wanted the Nobel Peace Prize. I think he was thinking that if I could do this and if I could do some other things, I'd have the best case to. I mean, if Obama, right? Because we know that he was critical of Obama winning the Nobel Peace Prize. Mm-hmm. Here, you know, I'm sure he thought that this would somehow offset all the things about Michael Cohen, all the bad things that Michael Cohen said. You know, racist, and all the things in the headlines during that hearing. I'm sure Trump thought that this would somehow just obliterate all that and show Trump as a conquering hero. But we knew going in that there was going to be some problems, you know, when Pompeo and Trump didn't seem to be on the same page. And so I just thought it was really kind of stunning when I'm waiting to see what's going to happen that Wednesday night, or was it Wednesday night going to Thursday, and suddenly they call for, you know, this press conference, and it's going to end, right? They're going to end the talk. So I was not surprised, but I don't know how many times Donald Trump can survive these kind of things and not have people say, that's it. I'm done. I mean, I'm trying to keep my, I'm trying to be fair and say, okay, well, let's, I'm just curious to see how someone survives all this, and how, I mean, I've heard of Teflon presidencies, but this is kind of ridiculous. So
the answer to that question is he's going to be tough to beat in 2020.
Yeah.
It will be a tight race.
And that to me is even more incredible, because I know that the polls have come out to show that, yeah, how tight the numbers are. All his antics only embolden his supporters, and now the Democrats don't seem to have a winning kind of answer.
Bernie,
Bernie. I like Bernie. I like Bernie. I mean, the first level of candidates have come out, and they're certainly more left of center. We're seeing, as we talk, Hickenlooper has now announced he's coming on, and we may see more moderates. I don't know if that's the answer.
Who came up with that name, Hickenlooper? W.C. Fields? Mr. Hickenlooper.
Hickenlooper. Yeah, so I just don't know. I'm trying to be I guess right now, as we talk, the whole border wall issue is coming up, and so some Republicans are maybe voting with Democrats. But look, I live in the Central Valley, and I see people with trucks with bumper stickers indicating that they are Make America Great Again types. And I don't see anyone from the other side reaching out to these people. And yet these are people who they don't really care. They don't really care about what Trump is doing. They just know that the system doesn't take care of them. So they're willing to throw a monkey wrench in the system and let Trump be their monkey, be their monkey wrench.
Well, my advice, we have to wrap it up. My advice is not to get angry at Republicans. I'm being trolled by Republicans. I have Republican friends who are trolling me. They want to get a rise out of me. And I just say, okay, wait a year. You're going to vote for Bernie. Make jokes, but you're going to vote for Bernie.
Hey, before you vote for Bernie, have you considered Andrew Yang?
I don't know who he is.
All right. He's the Asian American, other than Tulsi Gabbard, who's Hawaiian, and other than Kamala Harris, who's part South Asian. He's the other Asian American that no one hears about or talks about. But if you listen to him and go to YouTube and see his...
Where's he from?
He's out of New York.
Oh, he was running for... Last Tuesday, he was the Say No to Amazon party, the public advocate?
No, I don't think so. I don't think he's a public advocate. Andrew Yang is a tech guy, and he's decided to run for the presidency. He's a young guy, and he is
He was the former mayor of Atlanta, and he served in the UN.
That's Andy Young.
Yang.
Andrew Yang.
Oh, okay.
Andrew Yang is for the Freedom Dividend. Give everyone $1,000 a month.
Okay.
He's that guy.
I'm all for that.
I think if people give an Asian American, a young Asian American guy a chance, Andrew Yang may be able to get bipartisan support from the people on the right who don't want the government to take money. They want to put the money in your hands. So here, he's putting all the money into your hands. He's putting it $1,000 a month. And unlike welfare, he says, I don't take it away when you're successful. I give it to you even as you're successful, so you can use that money and put it back in the economy. So it really is a kind of trickle up kind of approach. I don't know. I've been watching his videos and reading about him, and I think the problem with Andrew Yang, with traditional Asian Americans and maybe some people of color, is that he doesn't come out of this civil rights mindset. He comes out of a new, what are we going to do about jobs? What are we going to do about automation? What are we going to do about AI taking jobs away? This might be...
I'm going to look into him.
He's also for universal health care. He's also for Medicare for all. So he doesn't stop there. He's not a single issue, but he is for what are we going to do about all these people who are going to be out of a job because of automation? We got to do something that's proactive in this freedom dividend of $1,000.
You know
a month.
Who tried that? Finland, who? Which has a higher suicide rate than the United States, just wrapped up an experiment giving 2,000 people a basic income.
Yeah, basic
income. A universal basic income. And they did it for a year. And the conclusion was that a universal basic income does not destroy your work ethic.
Mm-hmm.
It also doesn't make you look for a job any more than it would if you didn't have the universal basic income. But they found one thing out that a universal basic income does. It removes stress and it makes you happier.
A lot of people, if they just had that little bit of help and it wasn't associated with a stigma like welfare, if everyone got it, as opposed to the people who are really down in the dumps and poor and, this is welfare, you're taking, you're the welfare queen. If we could do it like Reagan and stigmatize it all, But if we said, look, this is your freedom dividend. And you know, the example is Alaska, where they get $1,000 a year.
I think it's more than that. I think it's like 2,000.
Well, it's not $1,000 a month. That was my point. But yeah. It is money that comes from the corporations and the petroleum, the oil companies out there. And the government, instead of taking it into their budget and misusing it, and this is why Republicans like it, this idea, they give the money to the people directly into their hands. And you know where they go, the people? They go to Best Buy and buy big screen TVs.
Mm-hmm.
But some will take that money and they'll maybe start a business. You know, maybe they'll start a business like a website in an area that is not covered by the news, because they live out in the out country in Alaska. Or, you know, I live in an area that is not covered by the news at all. You know, people can use the money.
America.
America. Yeah. America. This is the problem with America. Anyway, Andrew Yang, I think, has some good ideas. And I'm glad you brought up Finland. But I think they're killing themselves because their hockey team didn't do as well. I think that's the main reason why.
They're finished.
They're finished, yes.
Emil Guillermo, we're finished.
We're finished. Hey, you know, David, really, you know, I enjoy talking to you. And, you know, every time I talk to you, I am convinced I made the right decision not to go into comedy and to go into journalism.
Yeah, because you see what it's done to me.
At every turn in my life, I come to you and, you know, like, remember that time in Garvin's way back when I was talking to you in, like, I think some kind of like sanitation closet or something at the club?
Garvin's in Washington, D.C.?
In D.C., yeah.
I was in the clown suit, right?
No, I don't think you were in a clown suit, but we were back with all the, like, the cleaning supplies and stuff.
Uh-huh.
And I don't know, David, I might have to go and do comedy now, and you convinced me not to. Thank you, David. You saved my life. You saved
I don't know how you could.
That's an 800 number.
I think you were doing talk radio.
I was doing talk radio, yeah. Yeah, and I was considering I got to get into the open mic scene. I got to do this thing now, because if I don't do it now, I'll be too old later. And at every point, whenever I wanted to follow my comedy dream, you were always there to snuff it out. And I thank you for that, David.
Well, I was working in the newsroom at KRON, one of the top newsrooms in the country in the 80s.
Yeah.
And I was just starting out.
Yeah.
And I had a choice to make. Am I going to do stand-up or work in TV news? And I chose stand up because I felt, for me, there was more of a pursuit of truth and justice than local TV news. And that was coming out of KRON, which was like the flagship newsroom for local TV. You couldn't top KRON. But I saw the writing on the wall in the 80s. I said, this is not going to end well. Local news, I don't see this being nutritious.
Yeah. I think you're right. And, you know, there I was in the newsroom as a, you know, I had my little, you know, I was a...
You were,
was,
yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I, yeah, that was my heyday. That was my heyday. But at every point in my life, like I said, I would look to you and I'd say, David will talk me out of going into comedy. He will convince me. And I remember that time in Garvin's when I was like, maybe now's the time. And so that, you know, I appreciate talking, because every time
I had decided that there was more truth and justice in stand up than in TV news. And there I was in a clown suit playing Washington, D.C., speaking truth to power to an empty room. Emil Amok on Twitter. They can read you over
at Twitter. Yeah.
Okay. And they can read you over at the Asian American Legal Defense and Education Fund and listen to you every Wednesday on iTunes, Stitcher, wherever fine podcasts are dropped. The PETA podcast. People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals. Stand the line, Emil Guillermo.
We believe in democracy, not oligarchy. Today, we say to the private health insurance companies, whether you like it or not, the United States will join every other major country on Earth and guarantee health care to all people as a right. Healthcare is a human right, not a privilege. And together, we will pass a Medicare for All single-payer program.
You're listening to the David Feldman radio program, you sad, pathetic hump.